KJZ FM and HD1 Long Beach, Los Angeles. This is KJAZ 88.1, a service of California State University, Long Beach.
This is KJAZ 88.1. I'm Steve Tyrell as we cruise home together on this marvelous Monday, first day of the week. We're going to start this last hour off with Van Morrison, Sir Van Morrison, to you, John, with his most famous song, Moondance.
Well, it's a marvelous night for a moon dance, with the stars up above in your eyes. A fantabulous night to make romance, need the cover of October skies. All the leaves on the trees are falling to the sound of the breezes that blow. Yeah, I'm trying to please to the calling of your heart strength that plays soft and low. Yet all the night's magic seem to whisper and hush. Yet all the soft moonlight seems to shine your blush.
Good evening. Welcome to the City of Seal Beach City Council meeting. I call the meeting to order. Council Member Vera Papa will lead us in the flag salute.
Please join me in saying the pledge of allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can we have the roll call, please?
Mayor Masalave.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Vera Papa.
Here.
Council Member Deaton.
Here.
Council Member Moore.
Here.
Council Member Sestarsic. All present.
Thank you. By motion of the City Council, this is a time to notify the public of any changes to the agenda and or rearrange the order of the agenda.
I'd like to pull H, please.
Okay. Anything else?
I'd like to pull E, please.
I'd like to pull G.
Okay.
I'd also like to mention that I will be abstaining from F not being involved in a negotiation before my election.
I will also be abstaining from F because I'm unfamiliarity with this since I'm newly elected. I'm also going to be abstaining from the minutes of the special city council meeting because I was absent.
Okay.
Mayor Moslovit.
Yes.
If I may read into the record some information that was distributed after the posting of the agenda. We received an email from Robert Goldberg regarding a correction to the minutes of item A. We received an email from Robert Goldberg with questions regarding C, E, F, and G. We received an employee agreement for item F, Exhibit B, to Resolution 6709. We received a PowerPoint presentation titled Pier Fire Incident Update. And we received a PowerPoint presentation titled West End Pump Station. Thank you.
Does that affect the how we hear the rest of the agenda? No? Okay. All right. We will... Okay. Could you speak louder into the mic? We'll try and do that. Okay. Can I have... Can I have a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
With the corrections. Let me restate them. With the removal of B, E, F, G, and H. And is there a second?
I don't think B was removed, right?
B were the minutes?
B and F were not removed. We just need to reflect an abstention from Councilmember Sestarsic and Councilmember Moore.
Okay.
We don't actually need to remove them.
Okay.
Robin will take care of reflecting the abstentions.
Okay, that's fine then. Okay, so it's C, I'm sorry, E, F, G, and H.
Just E, G, and H. E, G, and H.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Please vote. Okay, that passes 5-0. Thank you. We have presentations this evening. The first one is from the local emergency peer fire incident update. And can we have a update, Mr. Spitz?
Thank you, Madam Mayor and members of the City Council. As requested, we're bringing to each council meeting the latest update on the current status with regards to the peer fire. As requested from the last meeting, I'm bringing this back with a couple more pictures just to show everybody. And in case new members in the audience weren't here for any of our past updates, this might give them a quick synopsis on what's happened. So starting off, I wanted to show a couple pictures. This was what it looked like right after the fire. So this is pretty much everything burnt. Some pictures from underneath. We were in a boat, went around it and noticed that a lot of the sub-decking members were burnt pretty bad in different areas. Again, another picture that showed where the old bait shack was. This, again, underneath the pier, showing a lot of the cross bracing and structural pile members that are burnt, especially towards the top. A couple of pictures of the work. We demoed all the structures that were at the end. We demoed the decking that was burnt. A lot of the sub-decking structural members, like the stringers, just the top portions that were burnt, and a lot of the utilities, like the Edison transformer, the sewer pump station, and some water lines that were burned at the end. This is towards the end as they're finishing up their work. You can see where the end of the pier was. There's a lot of open holes with just a couple of support members that were added in so that wave action doesn't cause any further problems to the pier currently. This is what the end looks like at the end of the demolition and what it currently still looks like. Railings to protect so that if someone should happen to go past block fences, that they can't get any further by. And there's a couple of walkways out there that were placed for engineers to perform observations and inspections. This is the last fence that we have towards the end of the pier that we keep closed currently and until this pier is finished construction. Again, this slide I brought a bunch of times, but this shows the locations of where the pier is open during the day and where we close it at night. Is because with electrical down, we don't have all the necessary lighting that we should have, especially toward the end. I brought this before, just go over this again. Some of the ongoing and future tasks for the pier is all the parts of the design to finish off full construction at the end, including electrical work, structural work, utility work, including sewer and water designs. Obviously, parts of it, since it's under an insurance claim, our insurance contractor has to do certain reviews of design work. There's also environmental and outside agency permitting that we have to go through. CEQA compliance, I can state right now that we're almost towards the end of that. We have gone through the reviews, and we should have a final document ready for EQCB board review and public review. And I can state also that at this point, we should be ready very, very shortly for our initial submittal to Coastal Commission, which is one of the longest timeline activities in the whole stretch. And then last one at the bottom, construction probably take 9 to 12 months once we first start. I brought a timeline a couple of months back. This was the one I brought back, I think, in the November council meeting that we put together at the end of October. It showed the timeline with all the events, and as you can see at the very bottom, anticipated finished construction 2019. You know, this was staff's best estimate and our educated estimate on the timeline of how long everything will take to complete and have the end of the pier finished construction and open to the public. You asked me to look into if there are any aspects of this that could go quicker if we were to try and push outside agencies, push the design process, things like that. So I put together another timeline that is kind of like a best case scenario. If everything works well, it's not too much different, unfortunately, but this one, the big key is this line right here brings Coastal Commission approval down to approximately 8 months, which is probably a best case scenario with that organization. With that said, all the other activities, including bidding and start of construction, puts a finish before 2019, depending on conditions of the Coastal Commission permit. I highlighted a couple months in green. Those are generally considered the summer months, and Coastal Commission generally does not allow any work at the beach during the summer at all. They will not permit it. With that said, either we can try and rush, get it done before, we can stop construction halfway through and continue afterwards, or we hold off and just wait for, you know, the day after Labor Day to start construction and have it done by, you know, April the following month, which was the original timeline. So we're going to push and push to go as fast as we can on all aspects of this. Like I said, we believe we're almost close to final approvals for our CEQA document, and we are just about ready to submit to the Coastal Commission the application. How they take it from there, we'll work with them, but we're just about ready to submit. And that concludes my presentation on the pier. If there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you. Councilmember Viripappa.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. Thank you for the pictures, Mr. Spitz. I really appreciate it. I think it gives a good indication of where we are right now. The question I had is, and if you could just remind the council and the residents, the permitting process to the Coastal Commission, what does that entail? Is that looking at the plans? Is that looking at the structural elements?
Looking at everything.
So they evaluate what we're already kind of getting designed for and so on and so forth?
Yes, every aspect of a project they want to see.
Okay.
And there are certain codes through their organization that they look for, certain aspects they will permit, conditions they'll place upon an application depending on what the kind of construction is, where it is, how it's being worked on, things like that. But yes, they'll look at everything from environmental to designs, to constructability, to materials, you name it.
So it's easy to see that the decking was damaged. How much of the columns or the piers were actually, can you tell us?
We're going through the design on that, but the structural reports we received did indicate that a good majority of the structural piles at the end of the pier were damaged, at least at the top, and they identified certain repair methods. Not necessarily removing a pile and, you know, driving in a new one. However, there's certain cutting and capping with sleeves and grout and jacking and stuff like that that the two structural engineers that reviewed the end have both recommended.
And is the permit just to add the decking onto the back onto?
The permit will be for all aspects of work. We do not want to go back to Coastal Commission, you know, 2-3 times for different aspects of work. We just want it to cover everything.
But I mean, as far as the structural integrity and everything below the deck and the decking itself, it's not to add another building on us.
No.
The decking itself.
Yes.
And everything below the deck.
Correct. It'll be for all the utility lines, especially the ones that were damaged, below deck structural and the decking, not for a building.
Right. Okay. Good. All right. Thank you.
Anyone else? Councilmember
I just have a quick question. I'm sure that, David, you've looked at this, but my question would be, is there anything that we can be doing simultaneously as it's going through Coastal prior to approvals?
Yes. In fact, we are pretty much doing everything simultaneously already right now. However, what I can say is they won't allow any construction to start at all beforehand. And it's good practice to put into the construction contract the conditions that Coastal lays out to the city so that the contractor can bid on it and have those ready for them. Mm-hmm. Now, when we submit our initial application, we're going to be, I want to say, towards final designs. You don't necessarily have to submit the exact final designs when you first submit. So we're going to be, that's why we're getting that application in as soon as possible.
Okay.
But we'll be working with them up to final design, final submittal.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you, Mr. Spitz. Our next presentation is the winter storm update. Jill Ingram, our city manager, will present that.
Yes, Mayor, thank you. Before I ask a few of our staff members tonight to discuss the incident response to the winter storms over the past week, I'd like to personally thank our entire city emergency operations team, including the Seal Beach Police Department, Seal Beach Public Works Department, Seal Beach Marine Safety Department, Orange County Fire Authority, our CERT team, pump contractors, and volunteers for their significant efforts on behalf of our community over the past week. I know without a doubt I'm speaking on behalf of the council as well when I say that our emergency operations team is to be commended for their professionalism, dedication, and compassion to prepare, respond, and work with residents to help protect their homes as well as businesses from the significant impacts of a severe storm, especially given available resources, storm drain infrastructure needs, the recent and extremely unfortunate West End pump station emergency, and storm impacts that were not limited solely to Seal Beach and several of our adjacent communities that several counties throughout the state. Especially want to thank and acknowledge nearly 60 staff members, several of which have been working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week over the past week to prepare for the storms, many of which insisted on continuing to serve the community over the weekend when they were ill, many of which were balancing the need to support, respond to the call of duty in Seal Beach while dealing with flooding impacts in their own communities and damage to their own personal properties. Council, as you know, we've been providing you with several updates over the past week, and so we're hopeful with the presentation tonight that we'll have addressed most of your questions. However, following the conclusion of the presentation, we're happy to address those as well. So tonight I'm going to turn the presentation over to David Spitz, our associate engineer, who will give an update on the West End pump station as well as some other updates. David?
Thank you, City Manager and Madam Mayor and members of the City Council. It's going to be a lot of information we're going to present tonight, both about the West End pump station and in reality the entire city as it relates to the storms that just happened and the weather we've gotten this last week or so. I'm going to start it off kind of with just a discussion about drainage in general and especially how it relates to Seal Beach, and then we'll kind of get into what took place this past week and actions that staff has taken, both Public Works, PD, Emergency Operations Center, and all other city staff to help protect city and city property this past week. Some of this I discussed a week ago at the special city council meeting, but depending on who may or may not have been here, especially in the crowd, I'm going to go over a lot of it again. So I hope it's not too redundant, but I'm going to push through it. For starters, the first thing I wanted to bring out is a couple of sections of our master plan of drainage. Now, what these are going to show is these are sections of our city, and it's kind of color-coded to tributary areas, and I just wanted to bring this forth to show everybody kind of like when it's raining, if a raindrop hits the ground, this is where it's eventually going to end up. This first tributary area is the area in the top right in orange, blue, I guess I'll call that a light purple, and a very dark green to the right. All that area is tributary to what we call pump station 35. It's a pump station at the corner of Electric Avenue and Seal Beach Boulevard, owned and operated by the county. It has three pumps inside it. Each are about 125 cubic feet per second, or CFS. And again, it handles pretty much everything in Old Town and the Hill area east of Main Street. Main Street's kind of a high point in our downtown area. Next section, what I have circled here is this, I don't know, you call it a pine green maybe. This is the West End pump station tributary area. And part of bringing this out is a week ago at the council meeting last Tuesday, other areas may have been included that should not have been included in this tributary area. But all this stretch of Old Town, the Hill, Bridgeport, all drains to the West End pump station, which pumps it to the San Gabriel River. The third section here, this tributary area, the one in pink, there's a single pipe underground, runs along Marina, and then it exits into the San Gabriel River. just south of the Marina Bridge. Single pipe, single flap gate opening, all gravity fed. Continuing in the city, this is College Park East, so I wanted to discuss this as well, because you know, storms hit everywhere in the city, so I wanted to go over everything. These different color-coded locations, like this purple, this, I don't know, I'll call it orangish, these are all individual tributary areas. Any rain that hits, for instance, right here will, in fact, drain to this point. So we have two tributary areas on the east side of College Park East, on the east part of this line. They drain into the Bolsa Chica Channel, which is over here. These other four areas, 1, 2, 3, and 4, all drain towards Lamson Avenue and then drain into the golf course. Taking a step back on those areas, you can see again, here's the entire western, I don't know, 3/4 of College Park East, and it all drains to these four locations and then drains, this is the golf course. Taking yet another step back, and this is important to look at, and I might back up a second here. Again, we have College Park East, drains into the golf course, then drains into federal channels running along Caltrans property, bisecting Leisure World, and into a county-owned flood control basin and pumped out through county-owned storm drain pumps into the San Gabriel River. And one of the reasons I want to bring it up is during some of the flooding or some of the ponding we've seen at this latest rain event, see if I can go back. Everything's surface flows into, there's a couple of storm drain pipes just at the end of Candleberry and the end off Ironwood at a couple other streets, but everything surface flows to those locations, then enter into catch basins, into a storm drain pipes, enter into the golf course. If the golf course is flooded, there's really nowhere for this water to go. You can't pump it north or south and then expect it to be, you know, less elevation of water in the golf course. And if Lamson happens to be flooded as you're driving through Lamson, that means the golf course is flooded. It means quite possibly the federal channel might be, you know, up to the very top, or possibly also overcapping the top of the channel, either at the flood control basin or in Leisure World or in Caltrans right away. But I just wanted to bring that up, that everything in this area, pumps or no pumps, is drains to the golf course. And just to show the one of the last sections of our city, this is College Park West. Everything drains, surface drains to the south part, and then again, they tie into the federal storm drain channels at the south part. I wanted to next kind of just talk about some rainfall data to kind of tie it into what we received here recently. So a lot of the information I've either gathered through Orange County Public Works, a lot of it through an organization called the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, also abbreviated as NOAA. You may hear that term coming up, NOAA, through National Weather Service and through some other sources to get some of this data. But what you're going to see here is just some historical rainfall data in Orange County. This goes back about since the year 2000. The national average, or the Orange County average, is at this line per year. So as you can see, some years were above. This was 2004, really, really wet winter. And some years were below. These are about the last 5 years where we were within drought. So as you can see, the full year rainfall data is well below the average. What I have here at the end in this special blue-white hatched area is this current fiscal year, 16-17. Now, as you know, we're only about halfway through, just past December, and I believe this number only goes through the end of December. And as you can see, we're almost towards the full year average after 6 months. I kind of want to show you what that looks like in a different chart for yearly rainfall data and as it accumulates throughout the year. This shows, again, Orange County average by month. So you can kind of see that obviously December, January, February, March, they're kind of your wettest months. The next part I want to show is what we've received this fiscal year so far. So this part was December. This number right here doesn't include anything that's happened in the last week. This was put together about a week ago. Because this past week's rainstorms, a lot of data hasn't been certified yet. It's still being accumulated. Just wanted to show what it was through about the first 7 to 10 days in January. Showing that a different way, this is a look at average rainfall in a given year, showing it as it adds up throughout the year. Obviously, when the fiscal year starts, July, August, September, there's no rain in the months, in the summer months typically. Rainy season usually begins in October, and as the months add up to December, January, February, March is our most rain, and then it kind of tapers off. Don't get as much rain in April, May, and June. Now, next line I want to show you was one of the wettest years we had in the past 25 years or so. I believe this was 97, 98. So you can see, obviously, a lot more than this is the average, and this is the rainfall, most of it coming in February and March. This next line will indicate one of the driest years. Sorry about my color choice, a little tough to see, but it's right there, very hard to see, not much rain at all. This next line I want to show you is last fiscal year. Starting to get a little better rainfall, still wasn't quite our yearly average that Orange County sees, but a little more in line with typical. This next part is what I want to show you currently for this year. As you can see, and this again is only through the first 7 to 10 days of January, we are already over the wettest year in Orange County in the last 25 years or so. And this doesn't even add the rainfall data that we're still gathering from this last 5 to 10 days, which could put us around here. Gathered some information from Orange County Public Works. They have rainfall gauges around Orange County. A couple of the local ones, gauge in Westminster and one in Huntington Beach. This shows the rainfall data collected over the last 5 days. As we all know, this had some rain Wednesday into Thursday, about 3/4 of an inch. Had some more rain through the day on Friday, averaged about an inch, and then rain on Sunday. Both Westminster and Huntington Beach both recorded well over 3 inches. And what I added also is there were media reports in Long Beach of over 4 inches of rain during Sunday, which would be the most they've ever witnessed. Wanted to add one more thing. We had discussions today with members of the National Weather Service, and they did some calculations for us, and they indicated that the average rainfall that we saw Sunday during that time period where it rained really heavy, averaging Long Beach, Seal Beach, and Huntington Beach, which is this vicinity, was 3.5 inches of rainfall. Now, what does 3.5 inches of rainfall really mean? Because we a lot of times we talk about amount of rainfall and flooding in those kind of terms in percentages. I know people have heard the terms like 10-year storm event, 25-year event, 100-year event. Just to give a little detail on that, when you say something's a 100-year storm event, what that means is there's a 1% chance of that storm happening. If you say a 10-year storm event, there's a 10% chance of that storm happening. Gathering data from NOAA's website, again, NOAA is the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, for our location, this is going to be really tough to read, but bear with me for a second. This shows on given durations, like how long the rain lasted, whether it's a half hour, 1 hour, 6 hours, 12 hours, and how much rain hit, it'll give us kind of the yearly storm event. So I wanted to kind of highlight, this is the 6 hour event duration. We can pretty much agree that most of the rain Sunday was between noon and 6 p.m. with the biggest duration probably about 1:30 to noon. But taking that, or 1:30 to 6 p.m., and then it tapered off after that and was just about done by about 7 or 8 o'clock. But taking that 6 hour time frame where most of the rain fell, and looking at 3.5 inches, which was the average for this area, I mean, 3.4 is already at a 100-year storm event. So 3.8? 3.8 puts us at a 200-year storm event. So at 3.5, we're well over a 100-year storm event in that vicinity. And that's kind of one of the keys I wanted to bring up before I move along in my presentation. Is that this was 120, give or take. Some of the meteorology agencies haven't really classified exactly what kind of real storm event we've had. They're still putting the numbers together. But we're definitely talking about a 100-year-plus storm event. This isn't something that we're typically designed to handle. I mean, we, as mentioned many times, there's a lot of aging infrastructure. Our master plans, and I believe when we took our five-year CIP outlook, we brought up that in order to really build and complete our city with all the storm drains necessary, we're talking well over $100 million to put in everything that's needed, College Park East, Old Town, the Hill, everywhere. We have pump stations that, as most people know, and I'll reiterate from the last meeting, our West End pump station at current design is built to handle a 20-year storm event. The design recommendations with more land and bigger pipes through the jetty and levees was for a 25-year storm event. What we had was well over a 100-year event. Full operation of the West End pump station wouldn't have even been able to handle what we received recently. Just, but moving on, we had a special council meeting last week on Tuesday where staff asked and council approved a emergency proclamation for West End Pump Station. The council approved $200,000, which was to be used to transport and repair the two non-functioning pumps at West End Pump Station by transportation, removal, transportation, and reassembly by Flow Services, Inc., and Cascade Pumps is the manufacturer that's going to dive into the pumps themselves, find out what's wrong, fix it. That money is also used for portable pump rentals, fuel for the pumps, an AKM design audit, and other contingencies during the upcoming rain events after Tuesday's meeting. What I can say, with Flow Services, since the meeting, we've issued a PO for $76,000, and that's for the removal of the two pumps and the transportation to Cascade, the manufacturer, and the reassembly and transportation back to our pump station after they're fixed. Cost by Cascade to do the final repairs, we're not sure yet. We don't know exactly what is wrong with the pumps, and we won't know until they bring them to their shop and break them down. Currently, Flow Services has already been to our site before the rains hit this weekend, and they've gotten into our well. There's a lot of work necessary to take those pumps out, and one of the first steps is you have to basically disconnect them from the housing in the system, and you have to get into the wet well to do that. So they came in after the council meeting before the rains and did all that work in anticipation of after the rains to take the pumps out by crane and truck them to Cascade to work on. We anticipate that happening very, very shortly this week. And as we've mentioned, we're going to have both the removals done in the same operation. Flow Services will come out, remove one by crane, put on a truck, send it to Cascade, come back, remove the other one right after, send it to Cascade at the same time. The emergency rain for rent rentals. As you know, before winter even happened, we had a couple of pumps that were rented, and when the permanent pumps at West End Pump Station went down, we had a couple of rain events end of December and the beginning of January, and we utilized those two emergency pumps that we had rented before. They, for the most part, handled the rain events. That with the existing sump pump that still works at the pump station. Those three together were able to handle the vast majority of the rain. We had then, right around council meeting, ordered another smaller pump. Cost of approximately $2,000. It, similar to the other two we had previously rented, rated at about 800 gallons per minute, minimum rating, and that's approximately 2 cubic feet per second, or CFS. Now, between those three pumps, and in reality we only used two of them, but between those three and the sump pump, we were able to handle the vast majority of the rain events before the council meeting. In anticipation of a larger storm event happening the upcoming weekend, with council approval, we rented two much larger pumps that we brought out to the pump station. Approximately $15,000 for the rental, and that's for 1 month. Rated at 3,000 gallons per minute, so they're about four times, give or take, bigger than the ones we had rented previous. Total of 7 cubic feet per second, and that price includes installation. There's a lot of the company has to install at our station. So I already put it up there. So we rented those. It rained Wednesday night and Thursday, and it rained Friday. During Friday's rain, those two large pumps plus two of the smaller ones plus our sump pump was handling most of the rain, but not completely. And again, anticipation of a larger event in a couple of days on Sunday, staff went ahead and ordered another larger pump. Now, one thing I want to bring out is there's no service that tells you, you know, in 2 days you're going to have a 150-year storm event, or, you know, next week prepare for, you know, Noah's Ark conditions. It doesn't happen. If it did, there would be weather alerts, news alerts, you name it, everywhere. Freeways would be closed down. I mean, there were freeways closed down. You know, flooding happened. You name a community, there was flooding. I mean, if we knew we would have a, you know, 120-year storm event prior, I mean, everybody would have, gosh, done whatever we could. But we rented pumps in anticipation of just larger events, given the information that we had and given the rain events that we were witnessing at the time and previous, and knowing the pumps that we had out there, what they were handling, what they could handle. In addition, one other thing, during the Sunday's rain event, we also had a Rain for Rent staff mechanic on site the whole day. Reason for that is, well, it's twofold. One is we wanted a professional with the company there in case something happened. We didn't want anything happen with those portable pumps. If something happened, one of the company's own was there to fix it. And in addition, that person was also monitoring the pumps, which freed up some of Public Works and other staff to be at other emergency locations throughout the city, whether it be putting out sandbags, signs, closing streets, and the such. And also another cost, I'm just kind of outlining a lot of the costs too. By the end of Sunday, we had already used over approximately 600 gallons of diesel fuel for all those temporary pumps at a cost of about $2,000. Another thing to bring up, we looked at the possibility of bigger pumps. In fact, the company had what they called very large pumps, high flow, you can call it. Pretty expensive, very difficult installation, very hard to get. They have large metal pipes, unlike some of the aluminum that we were using. Can't move it, can't take it out of the way. If you put it on the bike path, it's there for the duration. It's almost like it's built into our system. Takes a large crane to bring them, very large footprint pump. Not exactly sure if it could even fit and be set up correctly at our pump station. Also, from what we learned in discussions with the company, is these kind of pumps aren't even local. I think one of the companies said that it was in Bakersfield. They didn't even know if they could get it to us in time. So we did look at some bigger pumps, but again, going from the previous rain events, going from the pumps we had out there and our experience on what they could handle and how much they pumped, this is what we ordered and this is what we brought into our pump station to use. I'm just going to kind of show a couple of pictures. I know everybody here's probably seen what the storms did by their own eyes, but here's a picture of those three large pumps all set up. Here's your intake hosing. And this metal, I'll show another picture. That's your built-in, and again, the company, it's not just something they laid on the ground. The company had to completely install it, build it in place. That's your discharge hosing. These were those two smaller pumps, intake hosing. And here's the outlet hose, and I believe these are 12-inch discharge piping, all three. And those extend past the fence, over the bike trail, and into the San Gabriel River. Couple pictures of, I believe this is the shores at Seal Beach. This was during Sunday, different times. Here's a picture showing the three large pumps in action. And in fact, I think I have a video that kind of just shows their pumping capabilities. Let's see if this works. So that's the three large pumps, and you can see at the top, two other pumps were running as well at the same time. And what this doesn't show is also our sump pump was operating as well. This is kind of a picture from the other side. This shows where the sump pump exits here. These were the two built into the levee, the permanent pumps that will be out for repair. That's where they exit. These were the three large pump exit pipes right there, and this is where we had the exit hosing for the two smaller pumps. And this was, I believe, at about the beginning of when it was raining, right around 12:30, 1 o'clock on Sunday. Because what I can tell you is this is the elevation of the San Gabriel River when there's not much rain or when there's low tide. When there's high tide, it's much higher. In fact, that's why we put flap gates on these openings. And the reason we do is so that the river water doesn't push in into our pump station and thus into our city system. So when the pumps are operational and they push water out, it opens the flap gates and water is discharged into the San Gabriel River. But when they're not in operation and the river level rises, they're pushed closed by the pressure of the river and no water gets in. One thing to note, when it's raining really heavy and there's high tide, which this is low tide and the tide, you can see the general high tide line, that's the general, is right up there. When it gets higher tide and it's a lot of rain, this river actually gets above the flap gates. And what that does is it provides negative pressure to the flap gate openings. You run your pumps, there's back pressure. The pumps are much more than the back pressure, so they will still discharge water, but it won't be at the same pressure or rate as what your design capabilities are for the pump station when there's a huge rainstorm that covers those outlet pipes. So it's just something to note I wanted to bring up. Just a couple more pictures. This is towards the end of the rain event on Sunday, at probably about 5 o'clock. You can see it's pretty windy, too. These trees are really blowing up there. Another one. This one shows the pumps in action and the water level in the forebay, basically at the very top. No more water is going to get in there. This is now backed up into the pipe system and beyond out the catch basins at different low areas of our city. And this is one last picture I wanted to show. This was approximately 9 p.m. Sunday after the rains had already stopped. This is about when the water level in the forebay started decreasing. And shortly thereafter, we were able to get all the water out of there. And it should have been out of all the ponded areas in Old Town. So that kind of ends the first part of the discussion. What I'd like to do is turn this over to our Emergency Operations Commander, David Barr, for the next step.
Services coordinator. I haven't promoted to commander just yet.
They can't hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Here's the mic.
I'm the emergency services coordinator. I have yet to be promoted to commander. Here's some more pictures of some of the additional flooding. This is on First Street in front of Eves, about the 300 block. You can see it's nearly crested in the center. This is showing a down tree in College Park East. Pretty large tree. Additional flooding. This is near the entrance to the trailer park area on First Street near Eaves. So what I'm going to cover here is just basically a brief overview of what has been deemed Winter Storm Leo by the National Weather Service. And the bulk of that storm passed our area, as you've heard, multiple rough estimates. But for us, the majorest impact that we felt was between 1 and 5 o'clock or 1,300 and 1,700 hours. And we were, as you heard earlier, estimated to have received over 3 inches of rain over the last 12 hours and over 2 in the last 6. So in emergency services and for law enforcement, there's 4 primary areas of concern. Those were going to be: are there going to be any injuries? What can we do to mitigate those? Were there going to be any evacuations? Traffic collisions as a result of the flooding and the amount of vehicles that would be on the roadway. And, of course, just flooding in general. So one of the first things we did prior to the storm was on January 17th, which was Tuesday, we issued a press release, which also goes to all the local news media, as well as a NICSL notification detailing the anticipated impacts of the impending storm. These included the 7 sandbag locations spread throughout the city, the National Weather Service predictions of heavy rain and high surf, which may cause mild to moderate flooding. That was the anticipation on Tuesday. And the residents were encouraged to take the necessary steps to protect themselves and their property based on what we had on that Tuesday. Additionally, this message is also distributed out on social media via Facebook and Twitter. So then a couple days prior to the storm, Friday, we issued an updated press release, and again, via the news outlets as well as a NICSL notification, This included the following updates as a result of the increase in anticipation for what the storm would bring. And that was to not swim in the surf, to not park your car in areas that may flood. Some of those areas that we predetermined would likely be First Street between PCH and Marina Drive, Marina Drive between First Street and Fifth Street, to not walk or drive through the flooded roads, to drive courteously, defensively, and at a speed appropriate for conditions. One of the big concerns we've always recognized is that when the water level rises, people have a tendency to continue to drive relatively quickly, which causes a wake and can cause some problems there. So we put that in there to try and remind everyone to slow down. We also asked to watch out for city and utility workers because visibility and the amount of water that would be out there might hamper your ability to see them, so to pay attention for those, to look after your pets, and to report flooding, downed trees, or other storm-related issues by calling West City's communication, Westcom. This message, again, was also distributed on social media as well as Facebook and Twitter. So, on the 21st, which was on Saturday, we had two things that happened, and I left one bullet point out here, and that was we had our CERT team respond to the 8th Street lot where they filled up sandbags for local residents to utilize if needed. They filled up well over 600 sandbags, which was about 5 pallets worth. Some of those bags were left in the 8th Street lot in addition to sand and bags for anyone to use if those bags, filled bags were taken. And we sent many sandbags over to the Seal Beach Shores for them to utilize because we anticipated their area might see flooding as well based on the storm from the day before. Also, we had our volunteers, the VIPs, handed out rain and flooding flyers to each resident within Seal Beach Shores community just as an additional reminder that we were anticipating some significant weather to come in and for them to take proactive measures to help themselves. During the storm event on Sunday at about 2:17, keeping in mind that about 1 o'clock is when the rain really started to come down. So about an hour, hour and 15 minutes after that, we sent an alert OC message to residents of located south of Pacific Coast Highway and west of Main Street, about 1,200 residents, in response to the amount of flooding we were already seeing. And then at about 3:49, we sent out a second alert OC message to residents in College Park East, which is about 1,100 residences, in response to the amount of flooding they were reporting and that we were observing as well. So we pushed out those notifications. Most people at that point, if they walked outside, they knew what was going on at that point. So we were pretty confident that they were seeing all of those things. The Alert OC, if you're familiar with it or if you're not, you can sign up for that at alertoc.com and put your information in there. And also, I should have taken a moment to mention that you can sign up for the NCSL alerts by texting the zip code here to the number 888-777. So you send it to that number with your zip code, and that will give you the NCSL alerts. So going back to what we talked about earlier, injuries. That's a major concern of ours. There were no reported injuries during this event. Evacuations. There were no evacuations required. And traffic collisions, there were no traffic collisions reported. Now, for us in the police department, that in and of itself was amazing. Because when everything's perfect, we can get a lot of traffic accidents, and worked out pretty well that we didn't have any for us to have to worry about. Sorry. Flooding, the fourth area that we were concerned with. There were three notable areas of flooding. We had Old Town, clearly west of Main Street, south of Pacific Coast Highway, as we mentioned earlier. We also had Steel Walk, from about the 10th Street lot all the way out to Dolphin Avenue. And you saw some of those pictures earlier that showed that. And then, of course, we had College Park East. So in Old Town, the West End, south of PCH, west of Main Street, we distributed additional sandbag pallets over to the Seal Beach Shores during the morning hours, in addition to the ones that were already provided the day before. Seal Beach Shores did have flooding on all of their streets between 1330 hours and about 8 o'clock. So 1:30 in the afternoon until about 8 o'clock. And we were in there at that particular time, driving through there, and it took about 20 minutes for us to significantly notice no water to some water, and then another 20 minutes to notice a significant amount of water. So it was definitely coming down hard and fast. We conducted nearly continuous patrols within Seal Beach Shore specifically because of the amount of water that was in there between 1 and 5 o'clock. We spoke with residents. We looked for hazards. We didn't receive any specific complaints. We spoke to many residents who just had that look like, we know you're doing everything you can. We're good because we're a few feet above the water, and they were taking care of themselves, and they were good at that point. There were no other hazards or complaints noted. So, marine safety officers, and Chief Bailey will talk a little bit about this. We did ask them to assist us at the end of the evening when the water was starting to, or the weather was letting up a little bit. And they, again, like our VIPs did earlier, went to every single resident or every residence, and between about 5:30 and 6:30 to ask if there was anything that they had that they needed. And all of them at that point said that they were good. And you could notice pretty much that the water was receding at that point because the pumps were continuing to pump and they were getting the area clear. And so everybody was recognizing that things were letting up because the rain had diminished greatly. First Street between PCH and Marina Drive had flooding and was closed down for several hours. Again, we had mentioned to people that they should look at moving their cars, they should stay off of that street, and they shouldn't drive through it when you can't see the ground that you're driving on. A few residents did continue to drive through there, but the vast majority heeded the advice and they stayed out of that area. And then we had PCH between Seal Beach Boulevard and First Street at various times had flooding, and we needed to shut it down completely. And as soon as it was passable again, we let it into the center lanes, the number one lane. But there was a pretty good flooding through much of it from Main Street out towards Marina Drive, which had significant flooding as well. And at one point, First Street and Marina needed to be blocked off, and we had utilized all of the available equipment that we had, all of the signs that the city had. We used everything because that was all we had available. As a matter of fact, some of you might have noticed that we put a backhoe or a tractor at one place on Marina at First Street just to keep cars from driving through it because a lot of them were trying to push through. First, 8th, and 10th Street had portions of flooding between, again, 1 and 8 o'clock, Marina Drive, PCH to First, as I mentioned. Numerous Bridgeport streets had flooding, and numerous other streets within that entire area had various amounts of flooding. Usually the center was okay, but clearly as it bowed out to each side, there would be a significant amount of water. And then over on Seal Walk from 10th parking lot out to Dolphin, there was significant flooding. Seal Walk, that area, once it filled up, it stayed filled up until this morning when they brought in additional pumping to get that water out of there. They did respond with heavy equipment that day to try and dig a trench from the 10th Street lot on the south side, if you will, pulling it back towards the pier to see if it could relieve some of the water that was in there. It helped to some degree, but the water has a tendency to have a flat spot there, and you can't dig that deep to get the water to move out. But we were attempting to do that. And Sealway had portions flooded. Sealway, which is off of Seal Walk, had a good amount of flooding, too, in various spots between about 2:30 and 6 o'clock. So over in College Park East, Ironwood had significant flooding between Heather and Candleberry. Officers closed the streets and were later relieved by, again, many of Chief Bailey's marine safety officers who provided assistance out there to relieve our officers to go out to other areas to conduct traffic breaks and shut down other streets. Guava, Hazelnut, Elder, Dogwood, Candleberry, Birch, Astor, all of those streets had a significant amount of flooding. Numerous other streets in College Park East also had sporadic flooding, as anyone who lived in that area would clearly note. So this is basically the area of 10th Street looking back towards Dolphin. I mentioned that there was a significant amount of flooding. I think the picture demonstrates that. Go back there. So now I'll turn it over to Chief Joe Bailey.
Thank you, Corporal Barr. Can you just put my one slide up? Is it up? Mayor, City Council, I only have one slide, so this will be quick. And I apologize for renaming the Seal Beach Shores Trailer Park to the Golden Shores Trailer Park. First off, as a Marine Safety Department, our job in this situation is a couple-fold. But first off is the surf and the concern that the large forecast of surf would cause issue with our berm out there. Luckily for this, when this was forecast, we only had 4.5 to 5 foot tides that were scheduled for the weekend. So we knew that we were hoping we'd be in great shape with between the tides and the berms in good shape, and we just were waiting to see how big that surf was going to be. The forecast was for 10 to 14 feet, And it showed up to about 10 to 14 feet, but it was really stormy, and so it had broken up the swell a little bit and really didn't push up the beach that much. So the water that you saw in the last picture was all rainwater that was on Sealway. There was no ocean water that had made it around either side or over the top. So in planning for that big surf, we had one extra lifeguard scheduled for that day. We had about 30 people in the water all day long. It was good enough to kind of surf, and people wanted to go for it on the big surf. And then our next big surf event is actually happening right now, and the surf is probably 8 to 12 feet currently down at the beach, but the berm's holding up well. Once the rain event started for us, we were asked by the OCFA, who we had worked closely with. I want to point out that we had talked to the OCFA before the rain and surf event, and we had their dozers on standby in case we had an issue with our berm. They would be able to bring in their dozers and help us out with pushing up more sand. But we worked closely with the OCFA. They asked us to have available to them a rubber boat or a way to transport a patient. So if we had a patient, say, on Sealway or in the trailer park that needed to be moved out of their home, they asked, the fire department asked us to have flotation, so we would go with them on a medical aid, help them retrieve the patient, float them out to the awaiting ambulance. So we decided, well, let's call in everybody. So we ended up getting 14 lifeguards, both full and part-time, to come into work. Everyone's outfitted with foul weather gear, ready to go. And we made sure we had our inflatable boat ready to help with the fire department and anything we could do. We got a call from Corporal Barr and asked us to help him relieve their traffic control up in College Park East. We were able to send 7 lifeguards up to that area. We took the spot of some police officers so they'd be freed up in case they had emergencies to deal with. My lifeguards, you know, they're actually pretty excited to get away from the beach and help out any way they can, and so I think it worked out pretty well up in College Park East for us. And then lastly, before we went home that night, we performed a door-to-door survey in the Seal Beach Shores trailer park. The water at that point was anywhere between knee and mid-thigh height, so my lifeguards were happy to dive right in and walk around and talk to everybody, which they did. We didn't receive any complaints or any calls for assistance out of there. We're really happy about that. We let them know, you know, who to call and where to call if they needed anything. And then we went home and packed it up around 8 o'clock with all the lifeguards. Currently, like I said, the surf's in the 10-foot range and the berm's holding well, and that's going to be the end of my report. I'd be happy to hand it back to the city managers.
So, Mayor, that concludes our report, and I know there's probably questions of council if you direct to either David Spitz, our associate engineer, or Corporal Dave Barr from an overall broader perspective of the emergency response yesterday.
Are there any questions from council members? This is a pretty complete report. Council Member Deaton?
You want to go first?
Okay. Thank you for that report. It was very comprehensive. I think it helps to put into perspective what we all experienced on Sunday. It was a lot of water. I had no idea, David, that it would qualify for over a 100-year storm. So I want to go back, though, and ask you a few questions. What was the first date that we knew that the pumps were failing at the West End?
Trying to go back in for specific dates, but I believe the first pump failed December 22nd. And then we put the second pump on, and I believe the first failure notice of the second pump was January 5th.
Could you give me those dates again, please?
Now, again, I'm just going top of my memory right now, but I believe December 22nd was when the first pump gave our failure notice, and January 5th was for the second pump.
What did we do December 22nd when one of them went down? Did we call out mechanics?
That's correct. If we ever have any kind of issue with any of our pumps, whether it be storm drains, sewer pumps, water station, anything, our crews are mobilized right away to work through the problem. Depending on how complex or what kind of equipment may or may not be needed, we have contractors that will call in for assistance, which is...
So did they fix it?
No. No, wasn't able to fix the first one. We kept working with them into January, and that's where the second one went down. Again, they were already out there working, already trying to figure things out, and that's when the determination was that both of them needed to be removed to find out the problem in order to fix it.
Okay, so January 5th, the second pump went down?
I believe that's the date.
Okay. So, for Officer Barr, I was wondering what Facebook and Twitter accounts these are going out on, our social media.
It's ours.
Sorry. I think I demoted you too. While you you were promoted, now you've been demoted.
That's okay. It was the Seal Beach City, the Seal Beach Police Department's Facebook account, I believe is the correct one, and the Twitter account is the same.
So it's the PD account, correct?
Yes.
Okay. I don't do Facebook, so I'm not quite sure how it works and how people figure it all out. So what I'd like to figure out is how to get more access from that Facebook account out to people that I know are on Facebook for more information. So I can't help there. I just am curious. I wanted to talk about the wake, because you talked about the wake, and I know that when the cars were driving very fast, you had blocked off Electric Avenue down around 7th Street, right by the library there. And I sat there for a while in the storm and watched people try to transverse it anyway, go around your cones and around your signs and get halfway through and then start backing out again. But in the meantime, the wakes were causing the water that would not have gone up against homes to be pushed up against homes, and I don't think people realize how important it is to slow down and not put those wakes. You're really putting other people's property at risk. So thank you. I was personally saddened that we did have property damage, but my heart goes out to those of you that did flood, because some did. But I'm really happy to hear that we had no injuries, no traffic accidents, or anything like that. I want to thank the City Emergency Operation Team. It was a huge effort by a lot of people. Everybody was out there. Public Works, Police Department, Marine Safety, OCFA, Management, Pump Crown Tractors. And I also want to thank the many volunteers who worked so hard to mitigate the damage. CERT spent all Saturday morning out there with kids from the high school filling sandbags for citywide use. Save Our Beach, who is trying to keep up with all of the trash that's coming down the river to keep the beaches cleaner, and Neighbor for Neighbor, who were actually out helping their neighbors during times of crisis. And this was indeed a crisis. So I want to thank everyone, residents and staff, for doing the best that we all could do in overwhelming circumstances. I have so many other questions here that I think I'm going to save and just talk to the city manager about. However, a lot of them were also answered. One of the things I would like, though, is to request a full report on the cause of the pump failure from both the designer and the manufacturer, which I know, Jim, you already plan on doing, and a cross audit or a peer audit of their findings, so that we can get to the bottom of that. I also would like to know if our disaster plan is out on the website, and so that people can find out what is the plan for as things go, because as Sunday unfolded, it really just kind of fell apart with all of the rain, and we had everybody out doing what they could do, so there wasn't any real way to communicate at that point. So is our disaster plan out on the website? Do we know?
I don't believe that the actual disaster plan or the emergency operations plan is probably more closely what you're referring to.
Okay.
Is on the website. And in an event like this, the communication was very good between all of us. The difficult part, though, was the number of personnel that are out there. It makes pushing out any other information a little bit more problematic.
Exactly what my point. No, I wasn't saying your communication among yourselves on getting done what needed to get done was poor. The problem was that residents weren't quite sure where can I move my car, what do I do now type of thing, and all of our personnel were deployed. They were all out working and communicating well. So if we had a way that the residents could access information when they're standing there knee-deep in water in a car that's beginning to flood and know where to get it, you know, that kind of thing is what I was thinking of. So if we had a plan, like even if we said, you know, where the high ground is in town where you can move it. I know a woman called me and I said, you know, put it behind my house. I'm fine with that because I'm on higher ground so I could take it. So we need to identify that for all residents that want to take advantage of it was my thought. Okay, then the last thing, I guess, I think, David, you kind of covered it. I think what I would like to revisit are our recommendations on the infrastructure improvements. I know we have our plan. I know we're working toward our plan. I know College Park East is next on our plan. I know we've worked toward that. But, you know, maybe it's time to think about some other mitigations at this point. And I think that's all I have for now. Thank you.
Councilmember Moore?
Yeah. I just wanted to echo Councilmember Deaton's comments that while staff was in the process of working with contractors to assess the pump failure and determine if an immediate repair was feasible, that in the future these types of updates be provided at the city council meeting, if you know ahead of time, so we're aware that these pumps failed. However, I would like to point out that I appreciate how hard staff worked through the winter storm for the past few days. I was with the city manager during the week last week and was impressed with how often she checked in with various people to make sure things were getting handled properly. Also, additional pumps were ordered and put in place quickly by the city to minimize the effect of these recent storms. And I look forward to reviewing and discussing the results of the West End Pump Station audit to determine the cause of the system failure and determine if any additional maintenance is recommended and beyond what staff already conducts on a weekly basis. Thanks.
Thank you. Councilmember Sestarsic?
Yes, I'd like to also thank staff for all their hard work. I also was with Jill, and I see that they gave worked around the clock providing updates constantly, so I appreciate that. We did have a lot of water in College Park East. In my backyard, we have a rain gauge, and we measured 3.7 inches, and that was confirmed another weather underground station there. So we got a lot of water. Residents were concerned because we had some sewer improvement work done a few years ago, and so they were concerned because this, you know, they do not understand that it's still just a part of the work that needs to be done. So there's more work to be done. But, you know, I would hope we can still try to go forward with trying to get the water that collects there to go somewhere else. This one, there was so much water that, honestly, there wasn't anywhere for it to go. So, but also, one of the issues that we had were the wakes of the cars driving around. So we were trying to get roads closed so that the cars wouldn't wake up, because even if they were driving at normal speeds, it would force waters into garages, and the residents were understandably upset about that. So we did have police come up. I think it was one of Chief Bailey's lifeguards that closed off my street just when I was about to drive in. But I appreciate the work and the effort trying to safeguard our property and our residents. So anyway, thank you very much, and I do look forward to
continuing talks on maybe just a tiny bit of trying to get the water over to the golf course. Thank you.
Councilmember Viripapa.
Thank you, Mayor. Yeah, I did go out a number of times last week, probably a dozen times and three or four times a day over the weekend, and evaluated the situation on my own, and it was a lot of water. I also did a few ride-alongs with the city staff when they were anticipated, and I have to say that the emergency response team was really out there working diligently, along with the residents and the volunteers, and I commend all of them for doing that. I just had a few questions. Corporal Barr, you mentioned the OC alert. Can you describe how that works? So I don't know if I got it or if I get it or how do I get it.
So OC alert is a system that is managed by the County of Orange, of which we are a partner in, and that allows us to push out information to areas such as the entire city of Seal Beach with regards, or specific areas that we can basically geofence if we choose, that goes to whatever you've registered with Alert OC. It goes to all landlines, because those records are, unless you've opted out of having that number posted, for example, in the phone book, that number would be in the Alert OC system, and you would get a notification, a phone call to your home. Okay. If you register your email address or your working email address or cell phone, you could get text messages, cell phone calls. There's numerous things that are within there that will provide you with whatever information that we're pushing out. And in this case, you would have gotten a notification about the impending issues that we had, specifically with slowing down and watching your cars, and the flooding was occurring, and moving your vehicles, and things of that sort. But could it be any number of things could be utilized through that system. It's very effective.
Okay. And you also mentioned the sandbag locations.
Yes.
Can you just kind of walk us through? Is it up to each resident to get their own sandbags? Is it the city's requirement, or is it responsibility, or how does that process work?
Well, the city provides the sand, and they provide the bags.
Right.
It's up to the resident to fill the bags that they want to use for themselves. And there are some occasions where we will go out and start filling bags preemptively, like we did in this particular instance where we filled over 650-something bags.
So it's kind of a joint effort, then.
Correct.
I guess it's a homeowner's responsibility in the beginning to kind of initiate it if they think they need some bags.
Correct.
And hopefully they can do it, but I mean,
if they ever needed assistance, then they could clearly ask for assistance to do that. They might turn to a neighbor or a friend or their embodied, but they're there. The bags are there and the sand's there for them to utilize as much or as little as they need. Based on whatever their issues are, or whatever they're trying to preemptively place the bags for.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Can I say something on that?
Sure.
I had a constituent who called and could not get them out, and the city went right out and bagged for her. So she was in a very dire situation, and they went right out and did it. So the resources are there. Also, I thought it was interesting. Wink Chase and Patty Laird run a great operation, and Wink actually showed me exactly how to sandbag. It's actually a technique, and it might be something that we want to show as a video one time so people actually know how to sandbag, because you don't just throw a bag of sand up there. It's actually laid in like bricks and gone over the seams. So
that's important too. Mr. Spitz, I have a few questions. You talked about the pumps getting fixed. I know it's kind of early, but do we know how long that's going to take? I mean,
it's tough to really gauge. It depends on what's wrong with them.
Okay.
It could be very easy fix, day or two. It could take a week.
But you'll let us know as soon as possible.
Yes.
When that date occurs, and how long? I basically asked how long the pumps are going to take to fix. I guess if they don't have them out and diagnosed, it's kind of hard to tell.
Exactly.
But you will let us know ASAP.
Correct.
When we do know. Okay. How many pumps can fit in that area? I know you showed a picture of the temporary pumps. I mean, how many pumps were there? And how many can fit? I mean, did you maximize the space? Or?
Pretty much we did. We had those three, as we called them, large pumps out there, and the two smaller ones.
Okay.
With all of its intake hosing, all of the discharge hosing, all the necessary bracketing and structures to hold up the discharge hosing, it pretty much takes up a lot of space. And then to get crews in there to do necessary work, it was a lot of stuff out there.
Right. I went out there on Friday. I saw some of the operation. I know you're kind of imposing on Seal Beach Shores just because of the parking situation and stuff. Is there room for another permanent pump? A third pump? Eventually, not.
There is. The city does own property for a future, I'll call it an extension to the pump station.
Okay.
It's next to the current property. The current property, it does not have the exit hosing through the levees, through the Army Corps of Engineers owned and operated levees. So there's only the two discharge. Can't put a third one right next to the two pumps.
Right.
But there is room for future expansion.
The Orange County Flood Control District, why do they have three and we have two? Do they get more water than we on that side, or is it just, do you know anything about the history of that?
Usually when pump stations are built, there's hydrology studies that are conducted, and everything's built kind of per those results. I believe the West End pump station was built in 59, and at the time it actually had two pumps that were less than half the rate that the current two pumps pump at. The CLB, pump station 35, they call it, which is the county one with three, I believe it was built in the 70s. Don't quote me. I don't know off the top of my head. I can look it up. But it's a bigger tributary area, handles more flow, needed more pumps.
Right.
And I mean, the county may have just way over-designed and way overbuilt when they did.
So they own the one on the east side, and they own one up the river jetty in Long Beach, a pump station there, right?
Yeah, they own a pump station at off the, you can call it the end of Adolfo Lopez.
Was there any ever any discussion of OCFCD taking over the Seal Beach West End pump station?
I personally have no knowledge of any discussions. I wouldn't be able to answer that question.
I mean, something to think about. And I think, I mean, if they own the two, why not own one more? I mean, but I know they probably don't want to take it over, but something, maybe some dialogue could do we know if it, if we would have this much flooding if the West End pump stations were in operation? Do you anticipate it would have been the same amount of flooding, or is that a hard call to kind of make on this?
We're going into meteorology now, which I am definitely not an expert on. And, you know, as we all watch weather reports on TV, you know, it's a tough science to predict these kind of weather events. They can tell us when they're coming in. They can't tell us if it's, you know, 1 inch, 5 inches. They can, you know, they'll do their scientific and professional diagnosis. And these kind of this kind of information, you know, they provide on their websites and other such locations as this information is produced. And we as staff follow these websites. We follow this information. We have different staff members have good dialogue with different National Weather Service organizations and staff members there to keep up with, you know, anticipation. Again, we knew there was a storm coming in. We knew it would probably be bigger than what we saw previous.
Right.
But as far as how big, I mean, if like I said, I think I mentioned this before, you know, if every community knew exactly how much rain did come in on that Sunday, I think everybody would have tried to do so much more.
Right. Now, the West End or the East End pump station 35, they had the three pumps operating, and there was still significant flooding on that end too?
Correct. All three pumps, from what I've been told, were in operation. They're all in good working order. And again, with a storm of that size, that does not necessarily mean that the entire tributary area has necessary catch basins and underground piping able to handle the rainfall that we saw. So even if the very end point of that watershed can handle the total amount of water, it doesn't mean that all areas of the watershed can.
Right.
So yeah, there, even with the pumps in operation, there was still definitely significant flooding in different areas of the east part of it.
It seemed like it to me when I drove around myself, but I think, you know, I'd like to propose that we reevaluate the storm and infrastructure plan and start prioritizing these projects. We know that Seal Beach Shores and Bridgeport get some of the most serious and long-term, you know, have issues with long-term, and we need to resolve these. So I would propose that the council starts looking at those and prioritizing these immediately. And finally, is there a message that we'd like to give our public that wants to see these pumps in operation? You showed some really good pictures. I know that people like to look at the pumps in operation, but I know it's a dangerous condition, and I know people go there, and I wasn't the only one. I saw a number of people doing the same thing I was doing, but, I mean, is there a message or some information we'd like to share? And, like, if they want to see it, just don't go see it, or, I mean, a public service announcement? I don't know.
Well, we do have the area, basically, it's secure because there are so many moving parts, and when the generators are loud, you know, it's hard to stay focused as to where you're walking. So it's even dangerous for my own, for the own staff to be in that particular area. Certainly when the new pumps or when the pumps are fixed and they are in working condition, I think that's a good opportunity to hopefully on this, and if City Council authorizes it, we can have some tours, if you will, to see how pumps should operate when they are functioning properly.
I think it's a little safer out there.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
I have another question I'd like to ask. Go ahead. Okay, so do we have a date that we're pulling those pumps out?
We're doing our best to try to pull the pumps out this week.
Looking at David's weather charts, it looks to me like February and March may be more rain. So I think that we need to get on them, get those pumps out, and get them fixed and get them back in. And then we'll worry about all the other ramifications as we go down the road as to what happened and why it happened and so forth. But the most important thing right now is to get them out and get them back in fixed. Okay? That's all I have. Thank you.
Well, I did kind of travel around Leisure World after the storm, and I saw no major flooding areas. It was a river running by my house, by my little apartment anyway. I don't have a house. And it was pretty deep. It was probably 6-8 inches deep, beyond my ankles, I guess, up halfway up my calf. And it was pretty wet there on Sunday. But thankfully, our inadequate drainage system held, and there weren't any major problems in the entire section of land with 6,600 apartment units. So we got off pretty easy, and I'm sorry to hear about the damage and the concern from the rest of the community. My heart goes out to those people who experienced some real water damage and anxiety over the whole thing, and I'm sorry about that. A 100-year flood, everyone would love to build to a 100-year flood, but it never is adequate, and it costs, like, you know, $140 million to do that. So that's my report on my little area. And
Mayor, could I ask one more question?
Yes.
I went over to Guava and Ironwood, where we had the city was trying to help us out with a pump, and a couple residents were out walking around trying to see what was going on. There the water was knee deep, and we had I believe some car damage. I just wondered if the city was interested in knowing if about damages, or is there any kind of tracking on this, or is that that was a question.
I don't know.
Mayor Masuava,
Yes.
If anybody has a question regarding the city claims process, they can contact the city clerk's office. There are city claim forms available on the city clerk web page that you can download and fill out. There's a process that goes on along with the city claim form, including you need to submit your signature and any information that you have regarding the claim. That information will then be submitted to our third-party claims administrator, Carl Warren and Associates, to be reviewed for analysis to see if it is a claim truly against the city.
Thank you. That was a long report, and we had a presentation from the Orange County Human Relations annual report update, but they canceled this evening, so we're going to postpone that. Would you like to take a break now or wait until after oral communication? After? Okay. All right. At this time, members of the public may address the council regarding any items within the subject matter jurisdiction of the City Council. Pursuant to the Brown Act, the council cannot conduct or take action on any item not on the agenda unless authorized by law. Matters not on the agenda may, at the council's discretion, be referred to the city manager and placed on a future agenda. Those members of the public wishing to speak are asked to come forward to the microphone and state their name for the record. All speakers will be limited to a period of 5 minutes. Any documents for review should be presented to the city clerk for distribution. Okay, we're up.
Robert Goldberg, Seal Beach. Former chairman of the 2005 Storm Drain Committee. We've been through this before. We've studied it before. And as it's been mentioned, we have inadequate facilities in town here. I want to make 3 points tonight. The first is addressing staff's assessment that we had a 100-year flood. We did have a momentous amount of water. But before this 100-year flood becomes an urban legend, staff did not report any actual data, real data, from recordings in our town. Secondly, on the chart that they showed, they compared their numbers that they have for our total 24-hour rainfall, which in many areas was in the 3 range, to a 6-hour line on that chart. And so they are kind of comparing apples and oranges. What I've gotten is I've gotten data from 3 different locations, which they can, I'll send them to them and happy to share it with them, which indicate that we did have historic storms, but they were in the range of probably 40 to 50 year storms. And I don't want to belabor the point, but I just want to make sure that the record is clear right now. Now, perhaps the final analysis will be different. But for example, on the Hill, there's a weather underground station at the Hill, and they recorded a total of about 3.2 inches of rain. But for that 6-hour period, which was shown up in the chart, it wasn't 3.5 inches in 6 hours on the Hill. It was about 2.8 inches. Again, that's about a 40-year flood. There's a National Weather Service station right in the Seal Beach Shores, and the actual rainfall there was less, but was still... It's still considered a 40-year flood in the area of the West End pump station, which is important. The station on the Hill is right in the middle of the West End pump station drainage area that you saw before. Now, up in College Park East, inland, it was worse. At the Joint Forces Training Base, there is a National Weather Station there, and they recorded a total of 3.4 inches that day for 24 hours, with a 6-hour total of 3.1. And that works out to about a 50-year flood. And I'm getting these, my flood intensity is from a chart that it came from the Orange County Flood District, where you compare the amount of rain in a certain amount of time to the 2-year, 5-year, 10-year, et cetera. So we did have a historic amount of rain. On Sunday, the staff that was out there in the field deserve all the kudos and more for all the work that they did. But point number two is that, related to that, you know, we would have flooded no matter what they did, and also regardless of the status of the West End pump station, we would have flooded. But I think it's pretty logical to say that the flooding that occurred within the drainage area of the West End pump station, which included the area Max Auto Supply, Auto Repair at 7th and Electric, the library, PCH at 7th. I think we can conclude that that flooding was much worse than it would have been if our pump station hadn't been at full power. Our full power pump station is 200 cubic feet per second, and the five pumps that we had out there, I calculated them at about 45 cubic feet per second, or about 22%. The third
one
point,
minute, please.
Yeah. The third point is that while staff has kind of painted this picture that everything's been under control, maybe on Sunday things worked out, but they, third time's the charm. Sunday was the third flood that we experienced over on the west side, and the experience of those of us who live over there has been nothing but exacerbation. And the concern that I have is that I think from the beginning that staff didn't take seriously enough what failure of one pump or two pumps means at that West End pump station. And I'm now hearing tonight, thank you, Ms. Deaton, that the first pump failed December 22nd. We should have had a declaration of emergency then. At the council meeting on January 9th, when both pumps were out, staff should have been jumping up and down, screaming, because that's the situation. What we've had is more of a reactive approach rather than proactive, adding pumps after one flood, adding more pumps after another flood, and
time, please.
That's just not acceptable. Thank you very much.
Good evening. Tom Stratz. I'm president of the Seal Beach Police Foundation. I hope everyone knows by now that we are a totally independent nonprofit organization. Our board of directors is comprised of volunteers, men and women of this community. And we exist for the sole purpose of providing resources, unbudgeted resources, to the police department. Our message remains the same. We look forward to celebrate the return of Chief Joe. But in the meantime, we celebrate our wonderful police department but through our support. And I think that it's second to none, evidenced by their performance during this last week, and I, for one, thank them. We had a board of directors meeting this last week. As I mentioned, what we do is we provide resources that are unbudgeted to them. We voted to $2,500 to the Police Explorers for uniforms, academy fees, and equipment. And I'm sure you are aware that the police department has formed an honor guard, and we allocated $12,000 in support of that effort. So that's the kind of work that we're doing. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Charmin Snow, Old Town, Seal Beach. Who's here to support Chief Joe? I, for one, would really have liked to have had that man here while we had this this catastrophe going. I don't have any objections or anything. I actually really like our police department. We have got one of the best. But it would have been really nice to have this man, who has always taken care of us and we trust, be down there. He would have been moving things around. And we might have even gotten, well, I don't even know, why couldn't we bring in a pump for Seal Way? I mean, I know you had all of the temporary pumps over there, but we needed a pump on Seal Way. We always need a pump on Seal Way. We need a pump on Seal Way when it's smaller than this. Last year, you put two pumps on Seal Way. So it's not a new request. And it's obvious. All your resources were in use trying to save the city as a whole. I get it. But why? I mean, it's not that hard to rent a pump. So I don't understand the whole failure. This December 22nd date, you heard the audience. We're upset about that. This should have been taken care of. We should have had that emergency meeting way before January 17th. Thank you.
Hello. Hello. My name is Frank Boychuk, and I live at the Seal Beach Trailer Park. And I have some comments based on the report that I heard, which is, if we knew on December 22nd that the pump, one of the pumps was out, and it's been a month since we've known that, and still the pump remains in there with no specified date as to when that pump is coming out. We heard from staff that we think it's coming out this week, but we don't know for sure. So that could go on for 6 weeks before that pump gets out. The other point I want to raise is, why didn't we know that there was a failure before the 22nd of December? Then the other recommendation I would have is that when members of council speak to the public, that they should get the facts correct before disseminating information that is completely in error. Because I was told that we check those pumps every week of the year. And if we had, we would have known far before December 22nd that the one pump was not operational. So I don't know whether we're taking the pump situation seriously enough. I live very close to the pump, to the pumping station, and to have all those five pumps in operation makes it unbearable to live where I live. Secondly, I disagree with staff and with the question that you asked, which is, you know, how much room do we have back there? I have the best vantage point of that pumping station in the entire city. And there's over three quarters of space still available for another mega pump. Also, I agree with Robert that had we maintained the operation, the maintenance operation of the pumping station, that together with those two pumps and any auxiliary pumping configuration, that the flooding would be far less. So I think this whole thing was avoidable if we had prepared with forethought. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello. Good evening. My name is Oscar Aranda, and I am a resident here at the Seal Beach, City of Seal Beach, District 1, Ms. Deaton. Just wanted to make a statement, a comment, more than anything, a request. I have heard many complaints from residents within the city in regards to the response of certain departments here in the city of Seal Beach. More than anything, I'm concerned of the mistreatment of employees here in the city of Seal Beach, as well as the citizens of Seal Beach. Very concerned, specifically of this man, Jim Basham, who likes to mistreat women. So
excuse
I will be
me, do you have proof of that?
Absolutely, ma'am. As of today, my wife was an employee of the city of Seal Beach, and she resigned today with no notice because this man here likes to belittle people and his employees. So anytime, ma'am, that listen,
I think,
I'm going to be respectful.
You're out of order.
You're okay. Out of order.
All right. Then I will walk away, ma'am. But I just
thank you.
I ask you to listen to me when I reach out to you. That's all.
Thank
That's
you.
That's my request. Thank you.
Hi, Paul Yost, former city councilman, former mayor.
Speak into the mic so they can hear you at home.
Sorry. Paul Yost, former mayor, former city councilman. I was here at the emergency city council meeting. And first of all, I do want to commend staff. You guys do work incredibly, incredibly hard, especially when it's a dangerous situation, and especially when it's raining and it's challenging out there. And I do want to appreciate staff. The issue that I have is with management and the decisions that were made. I mean, we were down here at the emergency council meeting, and we actually gave city staff the model numbers of pumps that had a higher capacity that are provided by our existing vendor. And you guys ignored it, and you left us with less than 20% of our normal capacity at the West End pump station. It is totally irrational to expect anything other than exactly what we got, given what you provided, and that is a major flood. And it's not that hard to take a look at the Doppler radar and to get some assessment as to seeing heavy rain that is coming. And you were given the warning. You were put on notice. And then you had to flood two more times before that and add another pump. I mean, my gosh, you could have done a 60 cubic feet per second pump on that site, but declined not to. You gambled with our property and our lives. And we lost. And since at the emergency council meeting, a council member asked the city clerk if there were any claims that were filed, as if that is the measure as to whether or not there was flooding. I strongly encourage anybody listening to my voice right now that flooded to file a claim if that is exactly what it takes. I mean, my gosh, you guys gambled with our homes and our property. And so please, I mean, that West End pump station, I was on the council back when we had those years of heavy rain, and we went through this. Dr. Goldberg was on the Citizens Committee. And what I would like to propose to you is that you do another Citizens Committee and to look into this particular issue, because I don't trust the information that is coming back. I really think that you need to have some public oversight and adult supervision, for gosh sakes. I mean, we told you exactly what was going to happen given the cubic feet per second of the pump station and the status that it was at, and it happened. So, I mean, please, you know, listen to us. I mean, enough is really, really enough. You've got to protect us. There isn't really anything that you do that is more important than public safety and keeping us safe. And granted, we all know that when a 100-year storm is going to come, we're going to flood. But, my gosh, this must be the fourth 100-year storm we've had in the last 8 years. Thank you for listening.
Scott Newton, and I'm not going to talk about flooding. Other than to say that there was no question in my mind that our emergency services group was going to perform well. And the city, the police, the fire, marine safety, there was no question about it. And in this particular case, I think we were prepared and preparing. And I think even in an emergency where we weren't as prepared, they would have responded. Okay. But tonight I'm going to talk about... Well, first, I want to tell you that the community clock made it through the entire storm without losing 1 minute. Okay, so let's lighten it up just a little bit. And I don't think I've heard anything about coyotes in the last couple of days, so that's a good thing. But it's been almost 4 months since our chief was sent away because of an investigation. It's just too long. I come from the private sector. Things just don't take that long, and I realize this is a public sector. Don't quite understand why, but it is what it is. I respect that there is a process, but I think our community is getting, it's wearing thin. I think it's affecting many of our community groups to be as effective as they could be, because people are just out of sorts. I think some people have made comments and decisions that they they were probably regretting now. They really are. I've heard from several people that kind of jumped into this and didn't really know, and they were regretting some things, including me, saying some things or thinking some things. And we need to get back on a good playing field by finishing this investigation, and I am confident that a fair investigation is going to bring Chief Joe back to the city. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Nancy Cradell, and I live in the east end of Seal Beach by Seal Way. I live on Seal Way, the second house to the end, and I think we're orphans, because from what I understand, the associate engineer, could you tell me if we're attached? We're not attached to the county pump, right? We have just one small pump, and it goes into the ocean, and at high tide, it doesn't go into the ocean, right? Could we see that map again?
Why don't you answer the question?
We go to the Seal Beach pump.
Yes. There is no Seal Beach pump that you speak of.
It's ocean, just on the slant.
Ocean Avenue, half of Ocean Avenue will drain towards Electric on the north side. The south side from Ocean Avenue drains towards the boardwalk and the beach. Its natural drainage pattern is just to drain to the sand and then percolate into the sand on seaward side of the boardwalk. So all that rain that came and landed in that area was drained from Ocean Avenue down.
When Mr. Carmody was city manager, we had a very large pump. And in fact, even last year, we had a very large pump that must be 6 feet tall. Do you know of that?
We did put out temporary pumps last year for the predicted El Nino
winter. And our pump took our water from where we are over to the county. Is that right?
It took it inside of the harbor there. It's a natural flow. There's no pump on Seal Way. And in your first map here, one of the first statements that you made is Old Town feeds to the eastern pump. That is not true. Anything from Ocean Avenue down to the beach is a natural flow. There is no place to gather the water except on the beach, and that's where it flows. And one time I asked the engineer down here, why
did you use the mic? Could you use the mic,
here,
please?
Yeah. Why didn't you connect the Seal Way and Ocean Avenue to the main line? To the pump down there to the county? And he said, oh, I forgot. I mean, that's a hell of a statement. It's just like some of this stuff that we are handed here. And that, but that is not true, where that pump on the west side feeds all of Seal Beach, because we don't have a pump on our side. And besides that, I feel that we are the luckiest people in the world on Seal Way, because that could have been a disaster. And if there's damage done down there, and because any time that water comes up to these walkways inside of the house, anybody that has a heater that's on the floor, that's flooded. You can kiss that baby goodbye. And I'm actually insulted. My wife called up our councilman and asked her if we could have a pump down there before the storm. The city knew that storm was coming. It was advertised in the paper, and that we got no pump down there. And it was just, if that berm would have been breached down there, we'd have lost an awful lot of homes along Seal Way. So we were the orphan. They didn't pay any attention to us. In fact, they came down there today to pump the water out. And
after the fact.
So I feel that you people have forgot part of Seal Beach, and some of the stuff that you're saying here is not true.
I think something should be done for us. I think we pay enough taxes. I mean, my God, we do pay enough taxes to get something connected permanently. We should not have to pray for a pump every year, but or beg. I know Sean Crumby, when he was here, he gave me his phone number. He says, the first time there's anything, call me, I'll help. Well, we got no help. And it's really pathetic that we're all having so much money to do this and that and go out to lunch and, you know, spend it like water. But we aren't being taken care of, and that's a darn shame.
Thank you. Next.
Good evening, Council staff. Seth Eaker, resident, Old Town. Purely speaking as a resident and an activist. Number one, I was actually not in town at the time of the largest flood on Sunday. I was actually getting ready to do a TED Talk that's coming up. But what I did observe as I came back into town was heavy deployment, and I can confirm that I received the OC alert while I was actually in this meeting in Long Beach. So that advised me what closures were happening. So that system, I can attest, did work. I also received the NICSLs, so that was very helpful, and I saw our officers out. I would say that having been and continuing to be a business owner in the Main Street specific plan area, when the Dave and I owned the bike shop in the 300 block, we know that that area floods, just as Bridgeport floods, just as Marina floods. I would completely agree that wakes are a big issue. I know of one resident and business owner who was deeply frustrated and affected, and I would share with Acting Chief Miller and the team that I know that this one individual thought that he experienced some, and perhaps it was necessary at the time, some emergency vehicles or police vehicles that were driving very rapidly through that area at 7th and Marina, which actually caused additional wake that probably was needed at the time. But I know that he was very concerned about that. I think, too, it's a math problem that's pretty simple. If you only have 20% of pumping, you're only going to get 20% of the water out in comparison to 100% of the water out. And even if the 100% is inadequate, it would have been less. So I think that's pretty clear and obvious. And I think there should be a high degree of urgency on the part of council and staff to address these critical flooding areas, because I remember being with Councilwoman Deaton and the Cradells frantically trying to clear debris on Seal Way several years ago. I remember being on Main Street clearing debris away from storm drains as waves were lapping into Harbor Surf and we were sandbagging all along. I believe too that the CERT team, Wink and Patty, and their entire team deserve our highest and utmost regard, along with our other safety personnel, for really being there and helping our citizens out. And I believe that's an area that worked. So I think we have some things that work and some things that don't work. And we need to acknowledge both of those and try to fix the things that don't work. And this pumping situation is terrible. And we do need to bring Chief Joe back. We do need to bring our support to our police. We do need to support and trust our staff. And I think that you're hearing a lot of concerns of belief and trust. And I think that council, you need to hear that there are concerns and they are ongoing. And I would agree with Scott that it's interfering with the good work that many of us who are community activists should be focusing on, and instead we're distracted because we're trying to sift through other material. The last thing is a personal note that I would share with council and the entire community. Mike and Marcia Haley, our beloved Lions, and Marcia Haley is gravely ill and in critical condition, and the outlook is not good. So I, as a fellow Lion and citizen, and as someone who is connected to them, would ask for your prayers and thoughts for Mike and Marcia right now and their family, because we may be worried about flooding, we may be worried about Chief Joe, we may be worried about other things. Other families are worried about somebody dying. So I would remind us to keep things in perspective as well. Thank you.
Michael Bronfman, a long-term Seal Beach resident. Good evening, folks. Wanted to share something maybe a little different. I was out photographing and filming the whole weekend. I got drenched many times. I just wanted to thank our police, our fire department, lifeguards, marine safety people. I was all over the place, and they were all over the place. And I can't believe the effort. I was involved in a storm like this in upstate New York in 1973, and let me tell you, we're lucky we have these people because this was much better taken care of than that situation I was in before. Of note, when I put my video up the other day, Ellery called me because she wanted to have a look at the video and share the video, and I shared with her some of the things that happened to me. When I put that video up, I had tons of people call me, email me saying, what streets are closed? What's going on? There are a lot of people who aren't aware of the resources that we have, and so I was talking with Ellery about that. How can we get people to be aware of the resources that we do have of Nixle and those kind of things? So we talked about some of the ways we could do that. I think that's really important because there are people who aren't aware of the resources we have. I mean, I know it's been in the paper, you know, thanks to Charles and the people at the paper, but there's a lot of people out there who don't know the resources we have for information. So I think that'll be a good thing moving forward. So when these things happen, people, you know, I have friends coming in, it's First Street closed. I was getting phone calls like that just because of the video, but I wanted to share my thanks of everybody who was out there working, the lifeguards, everybody. It was a fantastic effort, and I saw it, and I really appreciate it. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Good evening, and thank you, Councilor. I'm, and women, my name is John Straub, and I live in District 3 in Galleon Way, which is Bridgeport. I'll make this quick. I wish some of the city people that work for the city would live in the city and experience what's going on, because there's a disconnect. You live here, you see it. The employees don't live here, so they go to their homes in other cities, and they're taken care of. Enough said. A few things that I'd like to request is more cell phone sites in the city. If you're sending out alerts and 90% of the people in the city have cell phones but no landline, how do you get the alert? I live in Galleon Way, and the closest cell tower is by the police department. That's knocked out by the old Boeing plant, or used to be another company before there. So we don't get cell service at all in Galleon Way. So one bar, two bars, you have to go outside. So if you send out an alert, don't get it. Another thing, the infrastructure of the city is degrading. The last time, I've been here since 89, the last time a street sealer has been placed was over 10 years ago. The streets are cracking. Water's going to go into the blacktop and eventually erode the base, and you're going to have to spend tens of thousands of dollars to repair those. So why aren't there streets being sealed with asphalt? Or not asphalt, but a sealer. Everybody mentioned more and more pumps. You had pumps standby last year with fences on Marina to transfer water from one basin to another. And Galleon Way flooded this past week. It flooded in December, and it probably flooded in 1999 when we had the last El Nino. But when water's coming up into your backyard and into the garage, and you're calling 911 but nobody's responding, there's nothing I can do. Sandbags would have never stopped this, because electric has large culverts, probably 4 feet by 8 foot, and our culverts going into that new section is probably only 24 inches or 36 inches. So when electric is full of water and it's backed up, it all backs up into Galleon Way, and I'm at the first house at the end where the culverts are. So I have pictures of flooding. Another thing about the alert system, they need to improve it, like Amber Alert. The city should have an alert system that goes out to everybody's cell phone in this area, because we pay a tax to the city of Seal Beach for utility tax for cell phone. That's $6. What are you doing with that $6? So put up an alert system. A tsunami's coming, or flooding, or what to do after an earthquake, where to go. You're getting money, use it appropriately. And the last thing I'd like to bring up is, what is the city doing for its veterans? You have a big Navy base here and a lot of retired veterans in the community. I worked in Long Beach. I worked at the hospital, El Toro, Tustin, Miramar, Camp Pendleton, and all parts of the world. Most of the Gulf Wars from 89 to 2010. When I went to the animal control place to register my service animals, I had to pay a $20 fee. I'm asking the city council to look at fees for veterans with disabled animals or that are disabled to see if they can waive the fee. Now, the state of California waives fees for disabled veterans on cars, so there's no registration fees. But yet, there's a fee for a dog. That's a service animal. So I'm asking the city council to consider that.
One minute, please.
Thank you.
Thank you. Chief
Joe, we're here supporting you.
Excuse me.
Name is Jim Plissan, and I live in Old Town.
Okay, go ahead. I'll ask you later.
So I have a question for you, Mayor, right away. I understand that in negotiations and that, whatever happens goes to the attorney. Is that correct? In regards to Chief Joe, anything that's happening gets reported to the attorney, correct?
This isn't the attorney that it gets reported to, but it gets reported to a attorney.
Okay. All right. So like everybody else, like Scott just mentioned, we're at a point in town where we need to know something. I mean, I don't care if it's just there's a meeting next week, so at least we know something's happening, or whatever can be put out gets put out so that people know what's going on. Now, last time I was here, I brought up some issues about lack of service or how people are being communicated to out of City Hall. And evidently some people watched it because I had several phone calls over the last couple of weeks with them referring their stories to me. And the gentleman that came in tonight is just another story. So there are things happening, and like I said last week, everybody in that building was hired to serve the residents and the community. And you serve them politely and with respect. And that better start happening. I'm not here to fire anybody. I'm here to have the chief get his job back. But what's going on in his community, and so much more of it showed up today. We have great people here. We have great policemen and firemen, and everybody worked their butts off this weekend. So we need to get things cleaned up. So please, start looking at things. Start questioning things. Start having meetings with your people and tell them how you want things handled the way Seal Beach residents want it handled.
Thank you. Chief, I'd like to ask you, in the emergency telephone system, can one enter their cell phone and get an alert?
Yes, you can.
Okay.
We'll put out more information on that.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Hi, good evening. My name is Ryan Schwartrock, a resident in Seal Beach Shores, and I just want to briefly note that we did have flooding. We had about 4 inches come into our place. We did use the sandbags, and we very much appreciate the sandbags being put out. In the end, we would have needed a much higher wall of sandbags to keep the water out. We appreciated all of the patrols being done by police, fire, and lifeguards. That was great. But we were very concerned about those pumps not working at complete capacity. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Ray Zioli. I live in Seal Beach in Bridgeport on Lake Corsair. Corsair Way. But in all seriousness, we had a momentous storm, and I think everyone in this room knew that a momentous storm was on its way. You know, every weatherman in L.A., whether it was a 20-year storm, a 40-year storm, a 100-year storm, to me it doesn't matter. We all knew that a momentous storm was on its way. And to go into this with 20% of design pump capacity, in a word, is negligent.
Hi, my name is Mario Iacoboni. I live in Seal Beach in Bridgeport. I lived there for over 20 years, and the whole time that I lived there, I worked for an agency that handles water, a lot of water, the LA County Sanitation Districts. I recently retired in May, but I still have contacts there, and I just kind of called and asked about availability of pumps and things of that nature. The wastewater plant in Whittier, actually, let's talk about the one in Harbor City. It's 450 million gallons a day. Just to give you some perspective, okay, 50 million gallons a day is 100 cubic feet per second in one pump, and we would handle pumps like that all the time. Now, I'm only saying that because I know you're not in L.A. County, but you're in Orange County, and there's a sister agency in Orange County, the Orange County Sanitation Districts, that I would beseech you to contact, because they have an engineering department, they have a purchasing department, they have contracts in place. I don't know how easily it is to, you know, access those kind of contracts and whatnot, but we would do things ourselves for other cities in Los Angeles. And I don't know how that works in Orange County, but you might want to look into that. And I will leave you with a thought, you know, excuse me for saying it, but bigger is better. And in this case, it is better. So think about that ahead of time, and it's not just the pump, it's the discharge. Make the discharges as large as you possibly can. You want to keep the head losses down. And one last thing, because I mean, everybody's talked all about this, and this Chief Joe, I don't know anything about it, but I sure would like to know what he did, you know, what and why he is no longer there, and it would help. Anyway, thank you.
My name's Veronica Ward. I live in Corsair Way. I've been flooded four times, 1995, 2000, and 2004. And in 2004, the city, the police department reported that we had a 100-year flood at 1.6 inches. I have the paper. I am so sick of paying ServPro to clean up my house. And I'm very, very tired because I've been doing sandbagging and bailing water for the last 2 days. Someone should have told me that the pumps were not operational December 22nd, and I could have saved my house, maybe. So I'm in agreement with Paul Yost and Robert Goldberg and all my neighbors. Something has to be done. This is ridiculous. Thank you.
My name is Dee Schulacher. I live on Corsair Way. In 2010, I lost my Corvette. I filed a claim with the city. Of course, I wasn't given any compensation for it. I just got the insurance for my car. But it was pretty discouraging and very, very upsetting. I spent the day today cutting out carpeting in my master bedroom, trying to get that taken care of. And I was so thankful for Robert Goldberg and Cindy Ludwig for helping me get sandbags in front of my house as I was gone this weekend caregiving for my mother. So I just want to thank, if it weren't for Robert Goldberg and Cindy Ludwig, I don't know what we would have done. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
My name's Paul Jeffers. I live in Seal Beach Shores. We've managed to form a corporation and buy that park ourselves, and we call ourselves Seal Beach Shores now, not the trailer park. You know, I visited a few people, or a lady on the back row right behind the pump station, Penny, today. And, you know, that is so noisy back there with all those temporary pumps. And I know Boychek, that talked earlier, he's really suffered with that stuff, too. I mean, those pumps are noisy, and it's not a very good setup. There's three people that live right along that way back there. And, you know, I went in there and looked in that area after the first flood. I can't remember what day it was. But the pumps then, there was like three or four pumps back there, and it wasn't a beautiful scene with these stainless steel pipes all laid parallel. And all. It was just some rubber hoses running all around back there. That was before the first storm. And I went to the office and asked, the management company what was going on since the first flood we had, and she didn't know anything. I said, could you call the city and see if anything's done? And evidently the next day is when you had that emergency meeting here, and I guess you put those other pumps in. But the big question that I'd like answered, and I asked at the office also at a management company, is weren't, you know, those pumps cost a lot of money. I remember I've lived in that park since it was built. and I know they rebuilt that station. I don't know if it was 8 years ago, 6 or 8 years ago. The whole station was rebuilt because it was failing. And all those pumps, I don't know who paid for it, but that was a lot of money. And I know I did construction work and worked on big industrial stuff. Those motors and them pumps cost a lot of money. And usually, the way I understand it, that there's a regular maintenance schedule, that those things are tested and regularly checked on to make sure they're going to work in emergencies. I've worked on high voltage in big hospitals, and they have these generators. And they're checked, I know, like, you know, every at least once a month they're checked, you know, emergency for the people. Can somebody, I understand those motors only had like 25 hours on us. Now, I'd like to be corrected if I'm wrong on that, but I've heard. And I'd like to know the maintenance schedule, what it was before this has happened. If I could get an answer on one of them, I'd really appreciate it.
If you'd like to go up to the Public Works Department during the week, they have a whole schedule that they can show you.
And you can't tell the public here right now?
I did last meeting, but I don't know if they have.
May I ask a question?
Go ahead.
Jim, there is a maintenance schedule in how they're supposed to be maintained. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And I believe you said at the emergency meeting that they are checked every week, every month, and as otherwise required in the service set out. Is that correct?
That's correct. Every Monday.
Every Monday. And you have a maintenance log that checks that?
Yes.
And that's the best I can do right now.
And it's been followed?
Yes. The problem is this. We don't know why the pumps broke. Yeah. We don't know why.
Must have been an act of nature.
Well, they have to come out and be analyzed, and okay. Then we need to find it out. But they need to come out and get fixed. That's the number one priority. Get them out and get them fixed.
I agree with that, and then they have to be taken care of.
That's right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Wendy DeBee, Seal Beach. Obviously, there's some wonderful people that responded and went all out on Sunday, and I think we're all grateful for that. And also, obviously, there's a little bit of a delay in terms of emergency situations and responses, and I think back to last year when there wasn't a berm and all of a sudden there was a storm, and so it was flooded, and the other cities, neighboring cities, were prepared, but we missed it a little bit. So there's a little bit of a lag, and obviously some trouble and some problems that need to be addressed. But for me sitting here tonight, the most troubling thing of all is a man coming forward and saying that our director of community development abuses women.
This is a personnel matter.
Excuse me, I'm talking.
That won't be.
Excuse me, I'm talking.
Excuse me.
No. No, no, I'm
this
talking.
This is a personnel matter.
That's fine. I'm
that
still,
will not be discussed in public.
That's fine. I'm still talking, and so is that person. And the point is that this is oral communication. This is the time for the public to come forward and talk about things. And so it's a First Amendment right to come here and talk about things that are happening.
You have the facts.
That's not. I'm talking the facts about what happened tonight. The facts are that a resident came forward and said something about this community director here. And so for you to say that they're out of order to speak is wrong. It's chilling. Well, it is. And it's chilling. And that silencing of residents is exactly what's wrong with this city right now. This is exactly why people have had it, because it's this arrogant, we'll tell you what's good for you, we'll tell you when to talk, and we'll tell you what to say, is not going to work in this town anymore. People have had it. This man should have been heard. That's up to everyone to decide what to do with it later and what personnel does with it later. But to silence him and tell him he's out of order is wrong. This is the time for public to talk for whatever they want. See how you do this?
Your point?
You see how you do this?
What's
this is my
point?
5 minutes. Why don't you just listen? The problem is you tell people what's good for them, and that's not going to work, and you should have listened to that man, because maybe what he said was valid, and maybe it wasn't, but it was his turn to talk and not your turn to silence him, and that's disturbing to me, and that's what's wrong here.
Anyone else like to speak? Okay, that's the end of oral communications, and we're going to take a break. Thank you.
years of service at California State University, Long Beach. Man, that was one of my favorites, tune by Grover Washington Jr. East River Drive from the CD Come Morning, got into that set with the Funky Organics. Groove With Me, the name of that tune, and it's a self-titled album by the Funky Organics. Coming up next, I want to get into Frank Sinatra. Hey, don't forget, if you're not a member of the family, it's easy to rectify that situation. Go to our website, jazzandblues.org. Bookmark that. That way you can always get to your jazz station, because we're here 24/7, 365, thanks to your ears and your generosity with your membership dollars on KJAZZ 88.1.
If you're undecided about how much to give, think about becoming a sustaining member of KJAZZ at just $10 a month. It's billed to your credit card, renews automatically, and you can change your amount at any time. And no matter when you tune in, you're always doing your part. To become a KJAZZ sustainer, go to jazzandblues.org.
Tell my fear.
Okay, let's re-something the meeting, re-adjourn. That's a new word. On the agenda is the city attorney's report.
No closed session and no report this evening, Mayor.
Thank you. City manager's report.
Mayor, if we could come back to this item, because I would like our associate engineer, David Spitz, just to clarify some information that was stated, as well as some council questions, and redirect those when he returns.
Okay.
So if you'd allow me the opportunity to go back to my item, I'd appreciate it.
Okay. Remind me if I forget. Council comments. Council Member Sestarsic.
Some of my comments I've already made. Thank you to Public Works, the Police Department, the city, all the people that put in endless hours working to help College Park East and the rest of Seal Beach. I did want to thank Assistant City Manager Gallegos for checking on Frontier. A lot of our residents, we have underground phone lines, and a lot of them are without service right now, and so they're having difficulty contacting Frontier, and those that have are told that they maybe will get fixed the end of the week. So one lady particularly called me. Her husband is on a Lifeline medical and is out of service, so I appreciate them being, hopefully can get in and get that fixed to get them back in service again. So, and I think that's all I have right now. Thank you.
Thank you. You might want to mention the...
That's right. I'm sorry. I attended the newly elected council person's
conference.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. Conference put on by the California League of Cities in Sacramento this week. It was really informative, a couple solid days of everything you need to know to be a council person. So I appreciate, thank the city for allowing me to attend and get the good information from this session. Thank you.
Council Member Deaton?
I've made all my comments, but again, I do want to thank everybody. Everybody pulled together, from the city manager to the maintenance workers to the lifeguards to the PD to the OCFA. Every single person in this city was working and forming a team, and thank you very much.
Council Member Vera Papa.
Yes, I've made all my statements too. Thank you, emergency response team and all the volunteers and residents.
Councilmember Moore.
Same, echo the great response by everyone in the city. And I wanted to say a few things. I'm excited about the new Leisure World Committee that the mayor and I will be on. And I really want to make sure that the goal is to make sure Leisure World is represented well with the city of Seal Beach. The League of Cities attended with Shelley and the mayor and the city manager, and one of the great things about this conference was listening to the concerns of other cities. I found that people are really there to represent their communities well and working hard to do so. I particularly liked the financial presentation that discussed the future pension liabilities, and there's a suggestion to create a five-year forecast. And I was glad to see that in our goal sheet and agenda tonight. I was also able to meet with staff from Travis Allen's office and Janet Wynn's office, where we discussed the pension problem, homelessness, and they were kind enough to offer assistance where we need it. Thanks.
I, too, would like to echo everyone's appreciation for the staff and what they did over the weekend. It was a monumental task. You handled it well. There was a lot of water to deal with, and you did an extraordinary job. I thank you. I attended the meeting in Sacramento for new council members and mayors, and It was excellent meeting. The first one I attended a couple of years ago was very good. This one seemed to be one step above, and it was very informative, and I'm certainly glad that I went. And I'd like to thank the city manager also. She, while we were sitting there listening to the speakers, she was on her email passing updates to us about what was going on here and the measures that were being taken and to deal with the rain and the pumps and everything that was going on. And I want her to know also that I appreciate that effort as well. And that will conclude our comments. The consent calendar.
Mayor, if I could, just
for, this when you want to come in?
Just for a moment under my comments, I think it's important, although the majority of the audience is gone, we still have a viewing audience at home, and I would like to give our staff an opportunity just to clarify some statements that were made. With that, I'll turn it over to David Spitz, our associate engineer. David?
Thank you very much, City Manager. There was a couple of big points that the public brought up during oral communications that both correlated to some of the actions taken by staff and especially to some of the words I used during my report. So I want to first clarify, when the question was asked by council, what were the specific dates the pumps went down? I used the word failure, and I'd rather not use the word failure. I'd rather use the word when we first received an alert. What I mean by that is if any time any of our mechanical stations, whether it be a sewer station, storm drain pump station, a water booster station, or a water well, whenever something does not work specifically the way it's supposed to, staff is given an alert through SCADA communication systems and other forms of communications. And if it's during the weekday, you know, staff responds right away. If it's at night, the alert goes in to our on-call personnel, and they come right out. And more often than not, it can be handled right away. It's a simple little thing. It happens all the time at our different stations. When I mentioned that date in December was the first time we just got an alert about that pump. So we came out. We looked. We did our normal diagnostics that our staff will do on these complex pump stations when we get an alert that something's wrong. I wanted to say that the first thing that we did was we switched over to the second pump. Typically, and one of the citizens mentioned this, that there hasn't been that many hours of runtime on those two large pumps in the last decade or so. It's been very, very dry drought years. Those pumps run when there's a lot of rain. Without a lot of rain, they don't run much. With that said, when we had the alert and the first pump was having problems, we switched over to the second pump. They're typically used as redundancy. Very, very rarely are both of them on at the same time. Very rarely. So they kind of act as redundant system. If something were to happen with one, you have the second one. And that second pump ran during the Christmas break. There was a couple of rain events where it kicked on and it ran fine. As we were doing our due diligence, looking into the first one and calling a couple of our standard pump maintenance contractors that we typically call to come out to look at the pumps. When towards the end of the first week of January, we got an alert on that second pump. That's when it was, we have an alert on our second pump now. Again, we did what we normally do. We came out. We went through our diagnostics. We called pump companies that are used to working on these. That's their whole business, these companies, is maintaining and fixing and working on these pumps. We called them out. They were doing their diagnostics again. Best case scenario, it's an easy fix and it's done right away. By the time that the pump companies told us, look, you got to bring this into the shop, it was after the January 9th council meeting. And that's where the process was, this needs to go on council. We need an emergency declaration and we need to get funding so that we can get pumps out here. When that second pump had the alert and we were working on it, we brought the two portable pumps that we had in the city at the time. We brought them over there, and there was a couple of light rain events that those pumps handled with the sump pumps still working, by the way. Those three in conjunction handled most of the minor rain events that we got. And We even ordered at that time a third one to have for standby for the rest of town, which was the intent of the first two to begin with. In conjunction of having the emergency declaration beyond just the two pumps not operating, that's when we saw the forecast for rain. And that's how staff took appropriate measures, that we see it's forecasted for more rain than we've had. We went to order bigger pumps. And this kind of moves into the second biggest question about the size of the pumps and the rental of the pumps. There was discussion on a much bigger, I think they mentioned a 60-something CFS pump. It's huge compared to the ones we had out there. It's a very big footprint. It's a very expensive pump to rent, and it does pump a lot more water than the first ones. We, at this time, in the order of events, we're working with these contractors still. We're hoping that we can get these big pumps out of there immediately to fix. There's a lot of work that goes into that. There's a lot of cranes, a lot of heavy operations. We looked at the available space at the pump station to do this work and to bring in portable pumps. And we made what we felt was the best decision on the sizing of the pumps that we brought in necessary to handle the storms that we've just had and that we saw forecasted coming up, and given the space that we had at our pump station. That's the kind of the order of kind of how we went. And I apologize again for using the word failure, when I meant at the time we got an alarm, and it's a standard thing that happens. In most situations, we fix and we don't bring it to council. You don't hear about every alarm we get. We handle it.
May I ask a question, please?
Of course.
Okay, so David, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use an analogy and tell me if I'm correct. In my car, I have a computer system, and every once in a while, the engine light will go on. And when the engine light goes on, it's usually a very simple fix. Actually, many times when the engine light goes on, I drive it over to the 16th Street garage, free advertising, and they say you didn't get your gas cap screwed on tightly enough. So I screw the gas cap on tightly. They reset the computer, and I go about my work, and nothing is no problem. Another time, that engine failure light may go on, and I get there, and they say, well, it's time to change the oil. So then we change the oil. Another time, the engine light may go off, and they say, hey, your whole exhaust system is shot, and you've got to put in a whole new smogging system. And at that point, the car has to go in to the garage. Would you say that that is a good analogy for what you're trying to say about the pumps?
I definitely like your analogy. Yeah. That alarm system referenced to the same as an engine light comes on is a great analogy. You don't know what that engine light means until you bring it in. You're right. It could be as simple as a gas cap needs to be tightened, or as bad as your engine block is about to fall and your car needs to be rebuilt.
All right. So that this gets reported correctly, December the 22nd, your engine light went on. You had an alarm that went off, and what you needed to do at that time was figure out why the alarm was going on. And that's when you put on the second pump that was used for redundancy, which then you brought in the mechanics to try to fix the first pump.
I would say correct.
And then when the second engine light went on, the second alarm is when you pulled in the pumps, and by now we were in the middle of the rainy season.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Go ahead, Councilmember Sestarsic.
During the break, I had a resident came up and reminded me that FEMA has loans for people that might have storm damage. I was just wondering if someone could expand on that, maybe. Anybody know about that?
I'm not aware of it.
No, you're not aware. Okay.
Something that staff.
But he'd had that when he'd had some damage. He'd gotten a loan through FEMA to get repairs. So I thought since that might be timely, I would put that out there. Thank you.
Particularly since we declared an emergency, maybe there is some state or federal money that can come through.
And I will add, we will look into all of that from a public works staff level.
Thank you.
Mayor, my only
final comment is we do listen to the public. We do listen to recommendations, even though we have experts on our staff. And we have expert contractors that are giving us guidance in addition to that. So I think it's important to note in this case, although the statement was made that we completely ignored the recommendations, we absolutely did not. I can tell you that because I was part of the discussion with the staff. I was over at the facility at least twice to look at what they were talking about and the recommendations that our contractor was giving us with respect to what would physically fit on the footprint of that site. So I think it's important to note, and we do hear you, we do listen, we do talk about it, we do follow up. Doesn't necessarily mean, as much as we hate to say it, that you're going to like the response, but I think it's important to note that we're doing our due diligence and we do hear you.
Thank you. That was important to say. Any other comments? Okay, let's move on to the consent calendar. The consent calendar has items E, G, and H pulled. Can we have a motion to adopt the remainder of the consent calendar?
I'll make a motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Please vote.
And Mayor, that would reflect Councilmember Starsick and Councilmember Moore abstaining on items B and F, as noted earlier. Okay.
So you have to...
No, they can vote. It's a consent calendar, so they can vote on the rest of the items. Okay. We're just having it noted for the record.
Okay, fine. Okay, first item E, City of Seal Beach Strategic Plan, 6-month Strategic Objectives Update.
So just for a quick summary of this item, Council, as you know, this matrix provides an opportunity for staff to give you a monthly update on the 6-month strategic objectives that you established with your executive team back in October, and so this serves as the monthly update for you. I think it's important to note as well, we try to be really aggressive, and as all of you know that we're there the day that we were working on these objectives in terms of target dates that we anticipate for completion on these objectives. And of course we want to be aggressive, and we have until April 1st to come back to you. Of course we want to try and get it done by that time, but I think it's important to note if we miss a target date, it's not because we're not working on it. There's other priorities that come up that pull us away from that. And so with that, I know Council Member Starsick pulled the item, and we're happy to address any specific questions that she might have.
I was just having I attended the October strategic planning meeting. I didn't get to attend the April one. I was just curious as to how we were doing. You know, I didn't see a completed or whatever, so I wasn't sure how we are doing on meeting our goals, and we have on target. And anyway, that it was just kind of a question of relating this chart to our goals and how we're doing.
So if you can see from the actual matrix, we have 4 3-year major goals, and then we've got several strategic objectives that have been identified for our focus over the next 6 months. And so you'll have some numbers that are identified under each 3-year goal. Hopefully you're noticing that these are some pretty aggressive strategic goals that you've identified us to try and achieve over the next 6 months. So at this point in time, I mean, we're still, it's been a couple months. We still have, you know, another 3 months or so to move forward with these objectives until we come back with to you in April. And at that time, you know, that's an opportunity for us to review with you on the status of where we're at and potentially revising those objectives as well. And so I'm happy to, like I said, address specific questions that you have, but I think it's important to note how aggressive these objectives are, and given the lean staff that we have and our ability to push forward with these, because they are above and beyond our normal day-to-day responsibilities.
Okay.
And Patrick, Patrick Gallegos in the city manager's office is the staff lead and works closely with staff on status update. So, Patrick, I don't know if you have anything else to add.
Thank you, City Manager Ingram. I do not at this time, but I could here to answer any specific questions. If it deals with any specific department, we can follow up with each of the directors if needed.
Thank you. I only have one question about it. Does anyone else have a question about the, I'm sorry, Thomas?
Just a few questions. On the Secure the Tidelands lease agreement for the beach, what's any news on that?
If I could, Jim, can you just give a quick update on that? I know we had submitted a letter to State Lands Commission in response to their proposed agreement, and we're at this point, I don't believe we've heard back from them, correct?
You're correct, Madam City Manager, in that the only response that we received from them after we sent the letter and disputing what they're asking for as far as lease terms is that their staff and management staff is reviewing our letter. And that's what all that. So we've asked for updates, but they're still reviewing it.
Okay. The other thing was it says hire a consultant to develop a 5-year plan for finances. Can you explain the process for that a little bit?
Sure, we can. I'll turn this item over to the responsible staff member, which is our finance director, Vicki Beatley. Vicki?
Thank you, City Manager Ingram, Mayor, and members of the council. Councilmember Moore, in direct response to your question, if I understand the intent of the question, we would hire a consultant to put together a model that will help us to be able to input data and make modifications to 5-year projections. So the idea would be to have somebody come in to assist in the process and actually lead the process to put all of the financial information together from across the city and be able to, especially given what's going on with the changes at CalPERS, be able to look 5 years forward and project some of the future costs with the city. We have some debt that is coming due, and so some funds will be freed up by not having to make those debt service payments anymore, and it will integrate all of those inflows and outflows and make projections. And having a consultant do it would allow for 100% focus on the project rather than having staff be able to do it as time permits.
And it's also a third-party evaluation of what's coming in and what's going to go out.
Absolutely, Mayor. And in addition to that, there's some other processes that are going on. For example, the water rate study is going on. And there's also a need to, from some recent legislation, to do a reserve study and have a policy for debt service reserves. So all of those things will be taken into consideration in a forward-looking perspective.
Good. Anything else?
Yeah, just when I'm looking at Robert Goldberg's comments on the objective on page C, fiscal response sustainability, objective 2 is to present new water and sewer rates to council. Previous target date was 2/27, and this is now 4/1. However, the status column indicates that this objective is still on target. So do we change some of these dates as this gets updated? Or
Councilmember Moore, thank you for that question. Yes, we certainly will revise these target dates. They will be reflected on the next staff report.
And can we keep like the original, to show if something changed from when it originally was projected?
Red line?
Yeah, like a red line.
That's a great suggestion. We'll do that on the next staff report.
I just have one small comment, of course. It's about the Coastal Commission. I'm noticing that the coastal development permit for picnic tables on the beach
is being held up because the Coastal Commission would like to know the type of benches and signs depicting the use of the benches. The benches are going to be used to sit on, and the signs will tell you that these are for sitting and for the public. So what are we going to give them something quickly? Do we have to give them the model of the bench and a photo of what it looks like and describe the signs? And
Jim, you want to explain as to what you did in fulfillment of that inquiry from Coastal staff?
Yes, thank you. We have submitted all that information that they requested to them. I believe it was going to be discussed internally within the Coastal Commission staff, either very near future or very, very soon, and we're hoping to hear back from them at that point.
Does this require a public hearing with the Coastal Commission?
I certainly hope not. And again, that decision unfortunately lies within the management staff as to whether or not they wish to approve it at the administrative level and just has it a consent item to show Coastal Commission that they've approved the item in case they wish to pull it for whatever reason, or they could do it as a public hearing. A lot of times they base the determination as to whether or not something goes as a hearing if they receive a lot of concerns or opposition from residences or anyone else.
Thank you. Okay, can we have a motion to adopt item E?
Mayor, could I just make one final comment?
Yes.
I just want to say in follow-up to the league conference that we were at last week, as you, Mayor and Council Members Moore and Sestarsic know, we heard a lot about strategic planning in one of those sessions and how significantly important it is. And I think it was eye-opening, at least it was for me, and it was for some of you as well, agencies that aren't doing it. And so for that, I want to say I'm happy for all of the four of us. We could check off that box that we've been doing it. And I want to thank the council individually and collectively for your leadership and your guidance and your commitment to continue, because it does provide us the guidance that we need in terms of what your vision is for us to move forward. So thank you for that.
Thank you. Thank the staff for doing such a magnificent job. Can we have a motion to adopt the six-month update on item E?
It's a receive and file.
It's a receive and file? Okay. Never mind. Item G, agreement and First Amendment with Municipal Water District of Orange County for water conservation participation. Can we have a staff report?
Yes, Mayor. Thank you again. David's getting a lot of airtime tonight, but I'm going to turn this item over to him for a brief presentation, and we're happy to address questions. David?
Thank you very much, and I'll try and make it brief. As you're right, I've talked a lot tonight. this item before you is resolution number 6710, requesting authorization for the city manager to execute an agreement with Municipal Water District of Orange County. Otherwise, we use the acronym MODOC for them a lot. For water conservation participation, and to execute the First Amendment to this participation agreement with Municipal Water District of Orange County. To kind of get into some background of what this is, Metropolitan Water District is the wholesaler for all of Southern California. A lot of the water agencies in Orange County kind of formed a district called Municipal Water District of Orange County, and what they do is they're an agency that works for all the Orange County water, or almost all the Orange County water districts. They lobby for funding. They perform a lot of the high-level governmental actions that is required of individual water agencies on our behalf. They have an operating budget to do this kind of work. They call this the CORE program, their CORE work, and all the participating agencies, in essence, fund this based upon size. Municipal Water District of Orange County also has what they call choice programs. These are certain types of programs that is really not a benefit of all water agencies, but only certain portions. So it's an elective program that agencies can, in essence, opt in to participate if it benefits them. For instance, on the staff report, I put couple of these choice programs. There is the South Coast or South Orange Coastal Desal Project. Now, we wouldn't opt into that because something down in South Coast really wouldn't benefit us up here in the north part of the county. However, there are other programs that we like to opt into, and one of them is the water use efficiency. There's many parts to this. MET, as I mentioned, which is a Metropolitan Water Authority, tends to fund a lot of these programs, and MODOC will work and act to administer them on our behalf. And if we, in essence, opt into some of these programs, we can partake of the benefits. In the past, a lot of these programs have had individual agreements for each one, and they were yearly. What was happening is MODOC was sending these agreements to different water agencies in Orange County, sometimes dozens a year, and was getting very burdensome. It was costing a lot more money to the member agencies because MODOC staff was spending a lot more time administering these programs. So what they are, in essence, trying to do is bundle all these programs into one agreement. And they want it not just a one-year agreement, but a 10-year agreement. And that's what they're asking to do. Now, a lot of agencies have kind of waited to see how this is acting and operating right after it was first rolled out. And there's been a lot of rewrites and some glitches with how this first 10-year agreement works. And so they've presented their first amendment already, and it kind of covers up some of the glitches. A lot of it has to do with the turf removal program that everybody's heard about. We would still like to participate in this program, and to do so, this is the agreement that MODOC is requesting of all water agencies in order to participate. What I can say is also the funding for these programs is through MET, and there's online applications that our residents can put in, and MET will fund this program. What the agencies must do, for instance, talking about the turf program, is we are required to, if we opt into that program, that allows our residents to participate, MET funded. We have to do most of the legwork at the site. We have to do the inspections, the measurements beforehand, the measurements afterwards, present those to MODOC, they present it to MET. Our residents can partake in the program. That's just for one example of one of the programs that we can opt into using this agreement. I even put the cost for MET's or for MODOC's operations as far as Seal Beach's participation level given our size. Typically, we budget during the budget process somewhere between $2,000 to $8,000 for this program a year. We can provide, if the council so desires, for extra funding to supplement some of the rebate programs. In the past, the city has not provided extra supplemental dollars. Most residents will partake in the program just with the MET rebates. So, again, just to reiterate, the opt-in type program, choice programs, what MODOC wants to do is basically bundle all of these options into just one longer agreement. This cuts down on the excruciating amount of staff time they spend, which therefore cuts down on the cost to all the participating cities. And I'd be happy to answer any questions on this item that you may have.
Are there any questions from the council?
Oh, I had a comment. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Can residents benefit from rebates, or what is the benefits for residents?
Yes, the benefits are usually, in essence, a cashback option. For instance, Metropolitan Water District offers, right now it's a $1 rebate for every 1 square foot of turf removal you do in your property. If, for instance, a resident wanted to change out, to conserve water, again, wanted to change out, let's say, 400 square feet of turf, if a resident should have that much turf at their house in Seal Beach, they could apply for that program. Staff would go out, measure, make sure, yep, 400. We would certify it. They would do the work. They would send in, or they would fill out the rest of the application at that point, basically the closure part, to Metropolitan saying, we finished the work. Can we have a rebate? They would send it to us. We would go out and do the final inspection, make sure, yes, you did take out 400 square feet of turf, and you changed it to drought-tolerant plants, to artificial turf, to DG, whatever. And then we would okay their application, and then they would get that $400, $1 per square foot rebate from Metropolitan.
Okay, thank you.
Actually, it's going to cost a heck of a lot more than $400, isn't it? Well, who's doing the work? The property owner has to have their gardener or whomever.
Yes, in that aspect, yes. The work by the work would be borne by the homeowner.
Okay, so they're getting a $400 rebate for the $20,000 it's going to cost them to do it.
Yeah, whatever it costs them to do it, they'll get that $400 back. Mostly they wanted to conserve water as the basis for doing it, and this was just a way, especially during the immense drought we've been seeing, this was a way to push a lot of people into taking these conservation measures.
I'm not going to dwell on that one.
Comment?
Yes.
I think that the confusion over the desal is because we opted into the Huntington Beach desal, and I think that's where the desal confusion is, that you're talking South County here. The Huntington Beach was an entirely different program. I don't know if you can talk to that or not.
I'm not too much of an expert on that, but what I can say, you're right. There's more than one desalination project, and certain water agencies opted in to participate with, whether it be the studies or other work, on certain desal projects that, you know, should they come to fruition, would greatly benefit their agency. We did in the past opt into the Huntington Beach desal. I believe fiscal year 14-15 was the last time we participated in that project. And I honestly couldn't tell you what the status of that is right now.
It's kind of on a treadmill at the moment.
Yeah, it's not really close to moving forward.
Yeah.
And Poseidon is too far away for us to participate in. Well, okay. Pleasure of the council. Someone want to make a motion here?
I just had one question while you're on it.
Sorry.
That's okay. I also had a question about Poseidon, because I remember that vote up here. Who actually on the rebates, what does the city do, and what does MODOC do, or what MED does? Because I bought a high efficiency washer like 3 or 4 years ago and put in the rebate and never got it. And then last year I said, okay, I'm putting in low flush toilets and I'm going to get the rebates, and I didn't get them. And I'm like, you know, I'm fairly confident. Usually I can do it right. So I'm like, well, did they run out of money? Nobody said anything anyway. So I was just curious.
I can definitely look into that for you. But in some programs, they've been on hold, and they took waiting list applicants because the money dried up at Met, and new budgets will provide new money. Yeah, that's
it's all right. I just was like, do I try again, or am I stupid at this?
There may be just waiting lists on certain. There may be waiting lists on certain programs while they're getting ready to fund it again, and there's a chance there's some waiting lists, in essence, waiting for us to approve this First Amendment.
Oh, okay.
And if they do that, there might be a chance that they'll release some if that's the case.
Okay. Would they go back, though, like if Shelley had done it last year, would they go back and start taking the ones that had already been put in?
I would highly anticipate that to be correct.
Okay.
And like I said, I can look into that for you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, can we have a motion to adopt G? Anyone want to make a motion?
So moved.
Second. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, all those, or please vote. 5-0. Item H, notice of completion for Council Chamber remodeling project number BG1401 and SBTV3, control room upgrades BG1402.
Yes, Mayor.
We have a staff report.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, Mayor, thank you. I'll turn this item over to our Deputy Public Works Director, Michael Ho, for a brief staff report, and we're able to respond to questions as well. Michael?
Okay. Thank you, City Manager Ingram, Honorable Mayor, and members of the Council. Item H for tonight's meeting is the request for accepting the City Council Chambers remodel project, and also direct the City Clerk to file the notice of completion within 35 days and release retention. So a bit of history. Back in May of 9th, 2016, City Council approved the plans and specifications for this project. And this project included relocating Seal Beach TV, adding bulletproof to the dais, adding a third exit to the chambers, and also panic switch buttons. This project was completed and accepted, and the project total came out to $398,000. The project budget was a little over $500,000, and the project came in within budget. And that concludes my staff report, and I'm here to answer any questions.
Okay, I pulled the item because I want to be sure that the public is aware that the sound and the visual of SBTV3 had nothing to do with this remodel. Am I correct about that?
That's correct.
Okay, well, we have been receiving a lot of complaints about the sound and the visual. How do we go about improving that for the public at home? Because as many people as come out here, there are a lot more that like to watch it on TV. Do you know the answer to that, Michael? Because I think it's not our budget. I think it's somebody else's budget, and I don't know if we can contribute money toward that. I don't know what the process would be.
Okay. I don't know the answer, but I'll definitely report back in the proper procedure in trying to get the audiovisual quality improvements.
Okay, thank you.
Mayor Moslovit?
Yes.
If I may provide
some city clerk.
If I may provide some additional information. I've too received and heard the information that both the audio and the visual is not always functioning as it should. I've been working with Robin through SBTV3 to try to see what we can do to improve it. We do anticipate that we'll be looking at potentially doing an RFP to upgrade the audio visual. We're also looking at, to speak of just the visual, the different components of that are involved. We're looking at upgrading that as well. That may be able to be accomplished through an informal bid process. We've been a little bit inundated with other projects, and I am trying to move that up the priority list.
Who funds it, Robin?
I have not seen that there's any funding through SBTV3, and I do believe it would be something that I'd be coming through City Council for. Currently, there most likely are not enough funds in the city clerk's budget. It's rather lean. But once I do have that information, we'll bring it back to council. And again, we are trying to move that up on the priority list.
Okay, thank you very much.
Any other questions from council?
Yes, I had a question, actually. In the staff report, it says that the project consisted of, among other things, installing panic buttons and bulletproof panels on the dais. But I didn't see both of those here. Is that correct?
To tell you the truth, I don't remember where the panic buttons are, but the bulletproof is down here.
I saw that. I was just curious about them.
So Michael and I talked about that today, and we just need to get a set a time when we can do a short tutorial for you. So hopefully you never have to use them, but in the event that you do, you'll know how to use them. So we'll work with you on that.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Then I'll assume that means everything's okay. Thank you.
I told her, I don't think we need panic buttons. We already have our police department here.
I know.
So great. I'm bumping my knee against my panic button pretty much every night, so I know it's there.
Okay, can we have a motion on item H?
I move it.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, please vote. Someone didn't do it?
Oh, I didn't. Sorry.
Okay. 5-0. Okay, we're going to move on to public hearings. We have two of them. Thank you. An ordinance of the City of Seal Beach amending section 11.4.05.010.D of chapter 11.4.05. Title 11 of the Seal Beach Municipal Code relating to allowable incidental business activities. Do we have a staff report?
Yes, Mayor, thank you. I'll turn this item over to our Community Development Director, Jim Basham.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, members of the City Council. The City Council on November 14th conducted a second reading of the ordinance in form. that related to allowing businesses to engage in entertainment activities. The form of the draft that was presented to you at that time required a public hearing for any business owner who wished to proceed with an application to have entertainment as part of their business. That form of public hearing will require additional fees from the business owner to incur relating to notification procedures. There was quite a bit of additional processes that was necessary in order to for that business owner to finally receive the granting of that process for an entertainment. There was also an appeal process that was associated with it. So during that meeting, City Council further discussed the ordinance and as to form and thought perhaps maybe there's a better way that we can do this, simplify it even more. And so what we've done is we brought back the ordinance pursuant to what City Council was asking for, and let's look at an entertainment permit that can be granted through the ordinance process by allowing it as pursuant as part of their business license application. So what we have before you this evening is such a draft that's ready for your approval for first reading. We've basically have identified in your ordinance by packet and exhibit that demonstrates that a great deal of the ordinance has been reduced into form. What has been included is just the operational standards that will be provided in the zoning ordinance that would allow staff to have some type of gauge as to how we review entertainment permits and if there are certain guidelines that everyone should follow, because the intent always from City Council is to ensure that we can allow an activity for a business to enhance their economic viability but also protect the citizens that are surrounding that business in case of nuisances relating to noise. So that ordinance is before you this evening. It's ready for open for public hearing and for acceptance of first reading. So staff concludes this presentation. I'll be more than happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Are there any comments from the council?
I just had one comment, and that was to retain the six-month reevaluation. We're still going to look at that.
Yeah, it's in
I
there.
Believe. Right.
Yes, that's built into the ordinance.
He's got both in there.
Okay. Yes. Thank
you. Councilmember Deaton.
Yeah, I just want to thank you very much for the work you went through. I think you kept what was essential to protect the neighborhoods and got rid of all of the stuff that was going to encumber business and staff. So I thank you very much.
Any other comments? Councilmember Sestarsic.
I just had a question on page 2 of the ordinance under little I location. It says the primary business would take place only within the enclosed interior area. I was just wondering on the definition of enclosed.
Madam Mayor, in response to the question, that would be specifically within the interior walls of the business.
Okay.
So it wouldn't be like in the exterior patio area or something of that nature where noise can really generate a great deal more than if it was in the confines of the interior of the building.
Okay, and we don't have any stipulation about windows or doors or anything like that being...
I do believe there's operational provisions that says that you need to maintain a certain noise level of that business. So one of the ways for which we can work with that business owner, if for some reason noise is being generated and we're receiving complaints, is that we can work with them to see if they're keeping their windows open, methods and ways where they can reduce that complaint.
On a per complaint?
Yes, case by case basis, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Councilmember Moore?
One comment. Can business owners, will they be, instead of having to visit the finance department and amend their existing license, could they grandfather their existing business license so they wouldn't have to do that?
Well, actually, there would be no need for grandfathering, and it's not. I don't think it's an additional fee unless the finance director who manages the permitting of a business license. It's just a matter of that business owner coming in to the business license division and saying, I'm adding as part of my business entertainment. So it's a method and way of us engaging as to the activities that are taking place inside that business.
Okay, and I agree with Council Member Deaton, that looks much better. So, thanks.
Just one comment on the business license and needing to go in versus the grandfathering. There are going to be two business licenses, and one allows the entertainment and one doesn't, so that the one that does allow it can be pulled for violation. So they would need to have the one that allows it. Does that make sense? I have a question on how are we going to hire someone who will be monitoring?
Actually, that's a very good question. I apologize, I didn't review that part. By the time this ordinance becomes effective, we believe we're already into spring. And so what I'm asking, actually, as part of implementation of this ordinance, if City Council still wants us to proceed with hiring a part-time code enforcement officer, I can build that into the upcoming budget. So it can be as part of the approval of the costs associated with that code enforcement officer, so that with that person, or at least that position, would be budgeted for the upcoming fiscal year. So during this time period, I can't even imagine that we're going to be inundated with a lot of businesses within a short period of time, probably like 2-3 months, of folks who's going to not be in compliance, if you will, of the ordinance.
Sounds good. Thanks.
Any other questions? Can we open the public hearing? Is there anyone here that would like to speak on this item?
I was wondering why you were sitting there so patiently.
Well, last time I was here was the LA Fitness meeting, so I'm used to waiting. Good evening. My name is Scott Levitt. I represent Taco Surf. Roughly 2.5 years ago, my clients came up pro per at that time, requesting an entertainment permit for their location in the Surfside Sunset Beach. I know many of you have sort of sat up there and listened to the back and forth. I'm here tonight just to say that Taco Surf is happy with what staff has done, and we are excited to move forward with this. We hope that the first reading occurs tonight, and that the second reading is the next meeting, and we would be the first applicants to apply for the Sunset Beach location. Also, on behalf of the Chamber of Commerce and as Vice President of the Chamber of Commerce, we too are behind this decision to simply amend the current municipal code and to have this process the way it has been presented as a city sort of over-the-counter process, the same way in which a business license is applied for and received. And of course, existing within the city is noise ordinances and violations, and Councilwoman Deaton was correct in bringing up what about enforcement. Also, there would also be enforcement allowed by the Silver Beach Police Department for noise violations within the code themselves. So if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. I've worked with Mr. Basham on this, and we're excited to see it pass tonight. So thank you.
Good evening, John Domain, Old Town. I just have a couple of quick questions because I haven't, unfortunately, had a chance to read the amended ordinance. And so maybe you can just answer for me here. I'm on two things. First, I know in the past you had mentioned you're going to require every performer that comes in to work into town and any of the establishments to get a city business license. I was wondering if that was still in effect. Because it's something you're going to probably want to check into. It's my understanding through some research that they do not have to. They are protected under the First Amendment. You don't have to, as you know, like I mentioned before, I've worked all around the world in these situations. I've never once, ever been asked to get a city business license to go in and perform for one night or a week or what have you into a nightclub or a restaurant. So that's, you know, that's a big thing, because if that's what you're asking, what that's actually going to do is keep performers away, and that's not good. That's not good for anybody. So anyways, that's the biggest question. And the other thing I had, I mentioned it Councilperson Deaton at your coffee talk about promotion. And I've been thinking about the response that you gave me. My question was, you said that if I recall correctly, there's no outside promotion allowed. So my question is, what does that mean? And the response I got was, are we trying to avoid anyone and a big send busloads of people in to a venue? Well, I understand that, but where does that happen? It doesn't happen in any area like this that I know of. And I've worked in just about every community and every county in California. So I'm just wondering if we could clarify that, what no outside promotion means. Does that mean a band member can't promote his gig if he's coming to O'Malley's, let's say, or just exactly what does that mean? So that's my two biggest concerns. And there are two big things that are going to affect the quality and of the performers that come into town, and also is going to affect just what the businesses can do to have a successful program. So if I could get an answer for that, I'd be happy. The rest of them I'm happy with, the sound barriers and all of that, that's great. I spent 35 years in loud noise rooms dang near every night. And the last thing I want to hear when I come home from work is more loud noise. So I'm a little sensitive to that. And I'm one of the, as far as I know, the only person with that dual experience. So I'm really sensitive towards it. And I have a lot of solutions for that that are very simple. And we're talking on a very small scale here as far as the number of businesses that are going to be operating with entertainment. And I just think it's real easy to control with a good, solid program, not only for the venues and performers, but also for residents, and have a number, somebody the residents can call, and just have somebody to walk up and just say, well, what's your excuse? The minute they call, what's your problem? Oh, yeah, I can hear the music. Let me go take care of that. And walk over to the venue in question and take care of it. You know, the big problem with enforcing things like that is the bands themselves, I hate to say, but it is, you know. You tell them to turn something down, and they turn it up. And I know you have things in place to combat that, but we really don't need to get down that far and really need to educate the club owners or the restaurant owners and how to deal with the performers and how to get what they need and make sure the performers are well aware of the consequences. So that's all I ask. And again, Ms. Deaton, if you remember a couple years ago, I sent you, or maybe, I don't know, it's been a while, an email and offering my services. I don't want anything for it. My goal at this is to see a good, solid program where performers can come into town and offer this town something that they really want.
1 minute, please.
Great. Thank you very much. So that's all I know. But the main two questions about promotion and about requiring business license for each performer that comes into town. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay.
Could we ask the planning director to address those two questions?
Yes, please.
Madam Mayor, in regards to the requirement for a business license, and the finance director can correct me if I'm incorrect, in accordance with Chapter 5 of the Municipal Code, if you're conducting a business within the city, and it's a business being conducted on a regular basis and you're being compensated for it, then a business license is required. It is presumed that you're filing a 1099 tax form with the federal government in that regard. So a business license would be required for a performer who's performing on, let's say, on a daily or regular basis. I know in questions in the past there was some examples given. Well, what if it's a high school that's doing a benefit, if you will? Under those circumstances, we would not require a business license. It's when somebody is engaging on a regular basis, a business or promoting themselves as a business or an entity that performs, and if it saps themselves with a fictitious name and so forth, that individual pursuant to Chapter 5 would be required a business license. And the finance director can correct me if I'm incorrect in that regard.
Mayor, members of the council, Director Basham is correct. I would like to add a couple of pieces of information. We do have, if someone is planning on coming in periodically, we do have a one-day business license that's available. The other thing is that the annual business license is this year $219, and there is an application fee that comes along. However, if the following year comes and the business license is being renewed and the individual has earned less than $25,000 in revenue in the city, then their license automatically becomes exempt and their first year permit is refunded to them. So then on the ongoing basis, they'll have the annual business license, which they can use at any business in the city that would have entertainment, and it would be a $25 fee annually to renew the license.
Wow, that's a good deal. Could you come up to the mic, please?
Excuse me. It's my understanding, through just some minor research, only really took me about 15 minutes to go through some documents, that performers coming, even coming into a business to perform these bands, are protected in the First Amendment. You can't make them get a business license to come in. That's my understanding. And that's going to be an issue, because performers just won't do it. And some performers are just not going to bother. They'll just go file a lawsuit. But they're protected under the First Amendment. I understand what your city ordinance says, but that's sort of trumped at the moment. Pardon that expression. But, you know, federal court rulings, Supreme Court rulings overrule that. So that's just something that I would really, really ask to take some time and check out that aspect of it before you enforce that. That's all I ask. This is my business. This is what I know. I don't know much, but I know an awful lot about running entertainment programs and very successful ones. And that's just something I'd like you all to check into before you leave that in. If there's any other questions about that, before I walk back, I'd be happy to take them.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much.
Yes.
If a restaurant's having a band from out of town and the restaurant has the business license, does that cover?
Let me jump in on this issue, because we had a discussion about this at the last public hearing. In the ordinance, a business license is required for a business or an activity that is carrying on a business, and as we discussed the last time this was before the council, the concept of carrying on a business has a certain sort of connotation of regularity, more than once. If somebody is doing something over a period of time, they're carrying on a business, and that's what we would consider to be a business that is subject to the business license requirement. I don't think, and staff can disagree with me, I don't think that staff would view a one-time performance by an entertainer in a cafe as carrying on a business in the city because it's a one-time activity. I disagree with the concept that the First Amendment protects performers from having to comply with various types of license requirements. All types of entertainment industries and entertainment businesses have to get business licenses, and so that's not a particular issue, but just by definition under the code, I think what we discussed with the council at the last public hearing is that this concept of carrying on a business, somebody doing something regularly over a period of time, is the type of business that's required to apply for a business license, not the one-time entertainers who are playing a gig on a particular night. And I think that was also the response to the question about the charity groups, the high school groups. Those things that just are incidental are not what the city would consider to be carrying on a business in the city.
Thank you.
And there was also a question about promotion, and I think there's maybe a misunderstanding about the interchange. The ordinance prohibits outside promoters from using a business in the city. So, for example, I know some coastal towns often have problems where a business will be rented out by a promoter who takes over the business and puts on various types of entertainment activities. That's not what's permitted by the ordinance, and that's in fact permitted by the ordinance. There's no prohibition against promoting So if a band is going to appear, you know, they want to put it on their Facebook site or whatever, hey, we're going to be at Seal Beach, there's no prohibition in the ordinance against that. What's prohibited is an outside promoter renting a business on Main Street and holding a lingerie show or any of the other kinds of things that often happen in that kind of scenario. So that's what's prohibited, the outside promoters of shows taking over a business.
Thank you. Any other questions from anyone?
I move it.
Well, let me close the public hearing first. Close the public hearing.
Now I move it.
You moved it. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, please vote.
Okay. And please notice this will be reviewed in 6 months and again in a year. It's in the document.
That's ordinance number 1659, an ordinance of the City of Seal Beach amending section 11.4.05.010D of chapter 11.4.05 of title 11 of the Seal Beach Municipal Code relating to allowable incidental business activities.
Thank you. The next public hearing is the extension of interim urgency ordinance number 1662, amending regulations for accessory dwelling units in residential zones in the city to comply with new state legislation. This is a zone text amendment number 16-2. Can we have a staff report, please?
Yes, Mayor. Thank you. Our senior planner, Crystal Landovazo, will present this item tonight. Crystal?
Good evening, Madam Mayor and Council. As the Mayor identified on December 12th, the City Council adopted Urgency Ordinance 1662 to establish temporary zoning regulations for accessory dwelling units in residential zones. This was adopted in order to comply with AB 2229 and SB 1069, which required cities to comply with new restrictions by January 1st. Staff provided an update on January 9th and is now requesting that the City Council hold a public hearing for a 10-month and 15-day extension of Ordinance 1662. This extension will allow the city to remain in compliance with state legislation while monitoring guidance updates provided by HCD before adopting permanent regulations. And this concludes staff's report.
Thank you. Any questions of staff? No? Yes? Okay. We'll open the public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak can do so now. Seeing no one, close the public hearing. What is the pleasure of the council? Is there any discussion? No? I'll make a motion to adopt item J, extend the inter-emergency ordinance for 10 months and 15 days.
Second.
Okay. Please vote. Okay. 5-0.
Urgency Ordinance Number 1662, an urgency ordinance of the City of Seal Beach approving a 10-month, 15-day extension to December 11th, 2017, the existing interim urgency ordinance amending Title 11 of the Seal Beach Municipal Code regarding accessory dwelling units and related development standards and declaring the urgency and immediate effectiveness thereof pursuant to Seal Beach City Charter Section 412 and Government Code Section 65858, and that Zone Text Amendment 16-2. And Mayor, we'll just note for the record that ordinance, unlike a normal ordinance, takes effect immediately this evening.
Thank you. There is no unfinished or continued business. There is no new business. And therefore, we are adjourning the City Council meeting to Monday, February 13th, 2017 at 5:30 p.m. to meet in closed session if deemed necessary. Note, that is the day before Valentine's Day. If we go past 12 o'clock, we expect roses.